Hello, everybody. And I want to say thank you to everyone who is tuning in. I know that you guys can be anywhere in the world, but for whatever reason, you guys are here with us again on a Sunday evening. Who's that? Momster? Hello, Momster.
Hello.
What's wrong with your face?
Nothing.
What's wrong with your face? Your face is like, you haven't, what's wrong with your face? Fix your face. Fix your face. What's going on with you?
Nothing. Tired.
Tired.
We went to a Black Heritage event today that lasted longer than they were supposed to. So it meant that we had to rush.
It's just, you know. Trash!
you did what you do?
Nah.
What you about to do now?
I'm a summer dude, but the show must go on.
Here he go.
Until I got to go. Y'all went to a hair show convention.
No, we went to something called the Black Heritage Tea Party or something.
Oh, okay. All right.
It was the first time that they had done it, and there was a lot of things that they didn't really think through. It was supposed to be from 2 to 5. They didn't have any food there. Like, okay, they had like vegetables, cucumber slices, and they had little muffins and nuts and stuff, but you can't keep people from 2 to 5 and not feed the food. And the tickets was $20.
Well, first of all, I mean, $20 is not a lot, but you know, they needed to have the chicken wings or something.
Stop. You know what I mean? Right. I'm not saying $20 is like breaking the bank, but when I pay $20 to go to an event, I expect to be. And the funny thing is, I asked her, like, is there going to be food there? And she was like, yeah, it's going to be tea party food. So in my mind, I'm thinking like finger sandwiches. You know, I knew it wasn't going to be like a whole meal.
Finger sandwiches? No. They gave you some cucumber slices.
No, at tea parties, you have cucumber sandwiches.
Yeah, one question.
You never had a cucumber sandwich?
No. Nope. Not going to say that I have.
Neither
nope.
Has your friend.
Cucumber sandwiches? No. I don't think that would rate pretty high on my menu of things to eat. Cucumber sandwich?
They're actually very tasty. But anyway, you know, it seemed like she probably just needed more help, and a lot of things weren't really thought through. So it was a tea party where we were supposed to have hot tea, of course, because it's supposed to be a tea party. They didn't even have a kitchen. So it's like, how y'all heating up this hot water? They had like one of those like plug-in type of kettle things. They was trying to heat up the water. It just was. So the water was never hot. Nobody had hot water.
Oh, no. That sounds sucky.
But this is what I'm saying when you try to support Black businesses. You see what I'm saying? We've had this conversation before.
Well, listen. Just because the event didn't go well, that doesn't mean that we give up on our people and don't support them.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? I'm saying that almost literally 80% of the time that I try to support Black businesses, it turns out like this.
That's why we got to do a workshop on how to do our Black businesses so when said such events happen, we are equipped and we know what it is that we're doing, so we know what we're doing when we do what it is that we out here in these streets trying to do. You know what I'm saying?
Like she said, the main thing is it's a tea. So you should have at least a microwave to heat the water up.
Yeah, so like even if you don't have a kitchen per se, right, you can at least bring a microwave or a coffee pot. You're going to need to bring more than one because they had 3 rows of long tables where at least 20 people sat on each side of it. There was a good number of people there, right? So you're going to need more than one little kettle thing to heat up this hot water, first of all.
Right.
And then because they had so many people there, the space itself wasn't so big, right? So because they had so many people there, they had like a little corner that was where the food was. You know how long it took people, everybody, to get to that little bit of food because it was only so much space to stand in line or whatever. Then she had vendors there, and where the vendors were, there was only room for maybe about four people to be in the area where the vendors were. So probably a lot of people didn't get business because I knew, I was like, I'm not standing in this crowded vestibule. You know what I mean? So I kept it walking. I felt bad, you know, and because of who I am, so many times I wanted to ask her, like, do you need help? Is there something that I can do? Because it just, you know, it was a good idea. I just think that, number one, she should have asked for more help because it looked like basically just her and her daughter running around trying to do everything the entire time. You can't plan an event to that scale and think that just the two of y'all is going to be able to handle everything.
You and your 17-year-old daughter.
Right, and her daughter's 17. It's not even like her daughter was an adult. You know what I mean? So she had. So not only was she trying to run everything and do everything and tell everybody where they are in the program and what to do next, she was also emceeing the program. She was also, she did a couple things where she was the entertainment at the program. You can't do all that.
No. But I mean, you know, listen, when you trying to do an event, you know what I'm saying? You try to cut cost, right? You try to cut cost. You're trying to, you know, put a little bit of money in your pocket, a little change. You know what I'm saying? So,
thing that I will say about the Black community, particularly if you church folk, because she goes to a church because she had her pastor do the prayer or whatever there. So she goes to a church, particularly Black church folk. They don't even necessarily want to be paid. They're always willing to help, right? Yeah. So I think it just was her. She just didn't ask for help, or maybe she didn't think she needed help. I don't know. But as far as, like, you know, helping, I feel like she could have got way more people to help her. And not necessarily had to pay them to help her, because if I'm your friend, if I'm your sister girl or whatever, and you say, I'm throwing this event, can you help? I'm going to be like, sure, what you need me to do? Because we're friends, we sister girls.
Right, but that's under the impression that everyone operates, you know what I'm saying, in the way that Ebony would operate to say, hey, look, girl, if I'm your home, you know what I'm saying, I'm going to come and help you if you need help. But not everyone operates under that same principle that I'm going to help. Most times,
church folk
in this day, in church this day and age, if you ask somebody to help you, the first thing they're going to say is how much you paying me, run me my money.
I don't know any people like that that I call. But anyway, church folk are always willing to help. And I know the only reason that we ended up being at the event at all is because she sent an email to my church email because she wanted our pastor to be one of the speakers. So, you know, what I know for certain is that she didn't pay any of the people who presented or spoke or whatever. And my pastor even bought her own ticket to come to the event. So, because in my mind, I'm just thinking, like, if you had me come be a speaker at your event, I wouldn't think that I would have to pay to come to it. Since you asked me if I would present at your event, but I ended up asking her, does the pastor need to purchase her own ticket? And she's like, well, if she can, that would be great. No problem.
Yeah, because she's trying to make that bread. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, but I'm saying is that if she wants this to be a success next year, she's going to have to do a whole lot of things very different, because now people already know what it was this year.
But just because you got it wrong the first year doesn't mean you can't get it right the second year.
Right,
just
but what I'm saying is that once you get it wrong the first time, it becomes much harder to get people to spend their $20 to buy tickets to this thing next time.
Hold on. Well, I mean,
on top of it, this wasn't her first event that she's thrown.
Right, it's an event center. She owns the place now. It's an event center.
And she's an event planner, she said.
Right.
So you trying to tell me you couldn't ask none of your friends to help you out?
Now, here's what I know. I could tell that she was an event planner because it was clear that they spent a lot of time and energy decorating. Right? The tables looked really nice. The decorations were really nice. And that was cool, but it started more than 30 minutes late. And it was a lot going on. It was a few times that I was going to get up and say, hey, let me help you with this because, listen. But I didn't.
Right. But I mean, look, let's just say, so What you do, right? You pull her to the side, be like, look, your event was okay, but here's some things that we probably could do better, or you could
have probably done better.
You know what I'm saying? And just
pull her number and her email. And she did say at the end of it that she wanted to know, you know, how people felt about it, whether it was good or bad. So I'm going to pray about it. And then I probably will speak with her.
Right. Okay, cool. Well, listen. Here we go. I want to thank everybody for tuning in to Steel Radio. I'm your man, Steel. That is my two lovely hosts over there. Ebony, a.k.a. Miss Hot Topic, who always brings the dirt. My man, Brian B. Rabbit, a.k.a. the Green Eyed Genie. And we're here on another Sunday evening. Thank you guys for tuning in once again. Again, we know that you can be anywhere in the world, but again, y'all keep tuning in. But thank you. We do appreciate it. We love it. We love it. So we just had to get the introduction out the way. And then, yeah, so I think you just should pull her to the side and just be like, or call her and say,
let me tell you, first of all, I really take issue if you're saying that I bring the dirt. I don't bring the dirt. I might dig up the dirt, but I don't bring it with me.
Listen, I was seriously considering changing your name from Miss Hot Topic to like the Undertaker, the Grave Digger, because you not only do you bring the dirt, you carry the dirt, like you said, you dig the shit up, you dig the grave. You prepare the caskets, you do the eulogy, and you put motherfuckers in it. But wait. But just before you do, hold on, but just before you do that, don't forget, you're also the bus driver to run over the motherfucker just as you throw the motherfucker under the bus. So I'm just saying,
are y'all going to let him talk bad?
Listen, like, I didn't even.
Can somebody defend me? Because I don't know what he's talking about.
Listen, I didn't even know you had your CDL license. Maybe you don't need a CDL license to drive the bus that you drive, but trust and believe, once you get behind the wheel, if you are in the vicinity, you're probably going to get ran over and thrown under that motherfucker. So
I think I disagree with everything you're saying. All I do is ask probing questions to get to the bottom of certain issues. That's all I do.
Because you want to dig up the dirt. You're an undertaker. He's a grave digger. He's a grave digger. Yeah, but you just want to bring up dirt. And the way you do it, it's like you just sprinkle this shit on a nigga, too. You know, you just like, this little sprinkle of dirt, you know what I'm saying? Just to get you going. And then, boom, there it is. The whole mountain comes down on your ass. And you just stuck like, huh?
I gotta get you comfortable first and let the flow is flow.
Yeah, like here's the sprinkle.
And then I just hit you with a question.
It's almost like going to the doctor and the doctor say, well, time for a rectal exam. You know what I'm saying? He talks real calm and shit and puts the gel all in your ass and just rams his finger up your ass. Then you be like, really, motherfucker? You know what I'm saying? Yeah, that's what it feels like. That's exactly what it is. Yeah, that's what it is. That's what you do.
Anyway. So tonight, the first thing we're going to talk about, because you know we end up talking about 15 different things before the show is over.
We always do. What we doing?
The first thing we're going to talk about is, first we're just going to clear, let's just clear some things up. You know what I mean? Let's just clear up the difference between a relationship and a situationship.
Okay, let's clear the motherfucking air, nigga. Let's get it popping.
Because, you know, we always make it seem like men and women speak different languages and shit. So apparently we're not all on the same page about the difference between a situationship and a relationship.
Well, what's the fucking difference then? Because I want to know. What's the difference between a relationship and a situationship? Because now we got, hold on, we got relationships, we got situationships, we got fuckships.
We got entanglement.
We have whatever ships. We have sneaky link ships. You know what I mean? So I guess what ship are you on? I mean, which ship are you on? Who's the captain? Who's the co-captain? Who's the fucking, huh?
I see you on the battleship.
What ship are you on? You know what I'm saying? I want to know, what cruise line are you cruising? Are you cruising? You know what I'm saying? The relationship, fuck ship, kinship, whatever ship. What ship? You guys are on the marriage ship.
Yeah, so we're on the relationship. But listen, the first thing I want to say, in my mind, the clearest, easiest way, and to me, the only way, you know for certain that you're in a relationship is if there has been some discussion and clarity that says, this is what we're doing. Because I think that the biggest mistake that particularly women make, the biggest mistake we make is because we're doing relationship shit, right? Because we talked about this before, right? We're doing relationship shit. That means the dude's calling you every day. Y'all talk every day. Y'all go out on dates. Y'all spending y'all time together and stuff. That you just start assuming that after a certain period of time, and I guess it's whatever period of time in your mind you make up, right? Because for one woman, it might be, we've been doing this for 2 weeks. For another woman, it might be, we've been doing this for 2 months. So I don't know how you determine your time frame in your mind. But you do those relationship type things for a period of time. You've just decided in your mind, we together, right? We in a relationship. Or sometimes we even convince ourselves or assume that because he's spending so much time with me, he can't possibly be seeing anybody else. I have all of his attention, right? So then again, we assume we're in a relationship. And generally, the only way that your bubble gets burst, right, is if some shit happens, or you catch him in some shit, or you question him about some chick or something. And that's when you find out, oh, you thought he was in a relationship? We were just kicking it. Like, you know what I'm saying? And now you're like, what do you mean we were just kicking it?
Right. Right.
So to me, the only surefire, solid way to know you are in a relationship is because you all have had a discussion, or he has asked you, or you have asked him. Because I know, like, once you get past a certain age, we no longer, like, say to each other, will you be my girlfriend? Will we, can you want to go steady? Like, you might not use those words, but, like, Brian, for instance, said to me, what do you think about making this? He said, what do you think about making this thing? Because we used to always talk about the fact that, hey, we're dealing with each other, we're talking to each other, but we're not really in a relationship. You're doing your thing, I'm doing mine or whatever. And I used to, in fact, say to him, yeah, because we long distance. Like, you know, in my mind, you all the way over there and I'm all the way over here. It's not even no real way we can say we in a relationship. And then one day he was like, well, what do you think about us saying this is a relationship? And I was like, oh, you and I? He was like, yeah, you know, a committed relationship. And I was like, well, what does that look like? Because we still live in different states, right? And so we had a whole discussion. There was no question in my mind. There was no question in his, right? We had a complete discussion about this is what we're now calling this thing we're doing. So to me, if you don't have some type of conversation where you both agree this is what we're calling this thing we're doing, you're never in a relationship.
Oh, okay. Brian, what were your words, man? I mean, what made you feel like, you know what, you went to this woman like, listen, chick, I want to be in a committed relationship with you, boo. What was the turning point, man? Like, what was the turning point in your life that made you feel like, you know what? Yeah. Oh, yeah.
See, I honestly, before he answers, he says it's not true. But I honestly thought that he did that to keep me from acting a fool on this cabin trip I was about to go on, right? Because I had been telling him I'm about to go on this cabin trip and I am about to do me, right? So in my mind, I felt like, oh, he's just asking me this because he wants me to go on this cabin trip with the idea. But he said to me, like, listen, I know this cabin trip was planned long before we ever got to this place or thought we were going to get to this place. So, you know, whatever you do with the cabin trip is your business. I'm not going to hold you. Like, you know what I mean? But in my mind, I felt like he knew the type of person I was. And the fact that, like, now we're saying, okay, we're in a relationship right before I go on a cabin trip was going to play some part in the fool that I acted at that cabin trip.
Not so.
But he said not so. So now you can tell them what made you or whatever it is that Paul asked.
When you're dealing with somebody, you realize, if you're paying attention, you should realize what you have with you or with somebody. You should realize if they're worth being in a relationship or not, because Like she said, she was doing her, I was doing me. Everything was cool. She was happy, I was happy, but I was like, I think we'll both be happier if we were together.
Listen, man, you're touching me right now, bro. Like, I mean, all up and through this area right here, like this area that's around in my heart right now, is just you touching me right now, right? I mean, your words are coming out. No, I'm just saying the word. I mean, it's just. Can you say it again for the people in the back who might not have heard you? Like, when you know somebody, when you got somebody that got you and they got, is that what you're saying?
Pretty much, yeah. I
mean, like, man, amen.
Because the main thing is, you want to be happy. I have been so unhappy in so many relationships. And I was like, nigga, you finally happy. And like we always say, I like her. So I was like, I'll come across to me and these motherfuckers, I got to hold on to this.
Listen, that is important. That is important, right? Just because I fuck you, that don't mean I like you. It doesn't mean I like you. It just means I fucked you.
Well, so that's very important. We weren't even fucking, so.
I know, because you was on one side of the country, he was on the other side of the country. Right, so. That is very important. Very important. So what was it about D that made you say, you know what, baby, go ahead. You know what, boy, stop playing. I'm going to go ahead and give you what you asked for. What made you feel that way? What made you feel that way?
I think it was because Brian and I literally could talk about like anything under the sun, right? We literally like, and you know, when you get to the point where like, you can't wait to talk to this person again. Right. And it just was like, we could literally talk about anything under the sun. We didn't judge each other. I could be completely who I was. Cause you know, often whether you even know it or not, you're not always being your complete self with people. Right. I think you realize early on, like the shit that you probably shouldn't bring up, or she probably can't handle that, or I maybe shouldn't tell him that, right? But I didn't have any of that with Brian, and I didn't think that he had any of that with me. It was just like, we're going to be our totally raw, authentic selves. And once we were, oh, you still here? Oh, that didn't bother you?
He's going to hear everything. And this was the big part about it. I've been in situationships where I've said, this is all that it is, and they ain't want to believe it. And they kept trying to change it, and it was what it was. I'm like, nah, nigga, we still where we are. With her, sex didn't cloud anything. We actually got to know each other without the sex clouding anything. It was just getting to know Ebony getting to know Brian, us having genuine conversations, learning each other, and growing.
Because we didn't have any choice to do anything but that, right? So, I advocate, you know what I mean? Because before Brian, I never really had a real long distance relationship. So I definitely advocate for that because, in my opinion, I don't know that Brian and I would be together today if we weren't long distance, right? Because we already said.
I was going to ask you that. I don't know.
I don't know. But I do know that because we were long distance, sex and the whole physical aspect of our relationship wasn't a big factor. And we didn't have any choice but to actually get to know each other and to actually have, you know, the kind of conversations that most people don't really have until later on. And then by the time you have them, you're like, yeah, but that dick's still good. Or we have fun together. So I'm going to just pretend like that shit we talked about don't bother me. You know what I'm saying? And so we had to talk through some things. Brian used to always say, what is it that you used to say when you wanted to dig into something deeper?
We'll unpack that.
Yeah, his favorite thing will be like, well, let's unpack that. You know what I mean?
Right.
So I advocate for it. I really think that, like, sex clouds people's judgment, whether we want to believe it or not. You know what I mean? Like, the physical aspect clouds our judgment quite often. And so you don't, and then somebody ends up saying to you later on down the line, didn't y'all talk about that? Didn't you know that? And you're like, well, no, we never really got to that.
No, I didn't really think about it. I didn't think of that. I was too busy humping.
Right. And sometimes, like, the physical attraction and the physical intimacy kind of overshadows all of the other stuff that y'all should be, you know what I mean, working out and talking about and figuring out about each other. So by the time we actually had sex, we had already told each other we loved each other.
Man, listen, this is just a, it's such a touching love story, man. You know what I'm saying? Listen, I'm going to write the book. I'm going to be the author. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to be the author and the director. You know what I'm saying? I don't know who I'm going to get to play you and him just yet when I write the book and do the movie. Because right now, we can, like, we probably do them, like, do, like, a little, like, a three-day mini-series type of thing, like they'd be doing the Netflix and shit. Like, it would be a good story. You know what I'm saying? Throw in some LS shit, you know, to get the people's attention.
Not to,
you know what I'm saying?
To.
And then the backstory be some real love shit. You know what I'm saying? Throw in some libations and shit. And I'm telling you, it's a Netflix special. It'll be a hit.
Yeah.
I think. I think it'll be a hit.
You know, but I think all of that, again, came from us just being open and honest with each other, right? So from the very beginning, we were very clear that we live in different states. And, like, it makes no sense for me to say to you, well, if we're going to be together, you can't have sex with nobody else. He's not fucking me. So, like, you know what I'm saying? But oftentimes, that's the type of stuff we do. And then we wonder why. Like, that's dumb. To me, that's dumb.
Well, I mean, being long distance, that would have posed the problem. That'll pose a big problem.
It's not realistic, right? You know what I mean? It's just not realistic. In either direction, right? Because I'm not sitting over here twiddling my thumbs or whatever. Like I said, we lived in different states, so we agreed very early on not to have unrealistic expectations of each other. And I think that helps a lot.
This is true.
But I don't know. So anyway, that's the only way I think you know for certain that you're in a relationship. Now, I mean, I don't know. Y'all can talk about all them other ships, but what y'all think about all them other ships? What is a situationship? Is a situationship like when you're I think like I just described, where y'all doing relationship shit, but y'all not really together? Is that a situationship?
I mean, I don't know, because, you know, a lot of these terms are terms that you just end up coming across. You know what I'm saying? Like, when you're talking to somebody. So, like, for instance, people say, are you single? Or are you single? And I'm like, what the fuck? What are you? I thought it was just, you know what I'm saying? So, no. I want to know, are you single? Or are you single? What the fuck is single? You know what I'm saying?
Well, I think single is like when you're not really dealing with nobody. Like, because here's the thing. Oftentimes, especially for women, I don't know if men have the same experience, but especially for women, we will meet a dude and a dude will be like, no, I'm single. I do what I want. I'm single. But then we find out later that they are dealing with like three other women, right? And by dealing with, we're not talking about, you know what I mean, they just went on a date or they just fucked them and now they're out of their lives. Like, they're basically maintaining some semblance of a relationship with some other woman. So if we ask her, what's going on with you or Paul? She's probably not gonna be like, oh, he's single and I'm single and we do what we want, right? So that's what we say. Are you single? Because single by your standards and single by some chick you're dealing with standards might be real different.
Mm. Okay, I get it. But I thought,
the question becomes, can any other woman, will any other woman be saying, you are her man or you all are together? Or are you
okay, so then ask the question then. So then, what is dating, right? So, like, isn't, because I hear women say, well, I'm, you know what I'm saying, just to be clear, I'm going to be dating other people, right? Mm-hmm. So does that mean, so, like, if they're dating other people and entertaining other people, right, so this dude might be like, well, I'm dating her. You know what I'm saying? So where's the line that you cross between dating, relationship, and situationship? Because in all of those situations, in order to get to know the person, you're going to talk to them on the phone. You're going to go out with them. You know what I'm saying? I guess the only real difference are the actual words, you are my woman or you are my man. But if
or
you don't, if you
the
never.
The difference is, are y'all fucking or not, right? Because a woman can be dating or a man can be dating multiple people, but not necessarily fucking all of them, right?
But what if both parties are fucking all the people?
Huh?
And they like, well, I'm just, what if the person is fucking all the people, you know what I'm saying? And, you know what I'm saying, whatever, because they're still trying to decide on which one they really want to be with. I mean, then what? Is that not, you know what I'm saying? So I guess where is the line drawn in a situation like that?
I think, and I
audience is awful quiet. Like, y'all ain't saying quiet. Shit. Like,
they are quiet.
They're real quiet tonight.
I think maybe the difference is just your level of honesty about it, right? Because oftentimes, particularly if we fucking, most dudes are not telling the chick that they're fucking, any of them. You know I'm dating other people, right? Because that basically, you know I'm fucking other people, right? Most dudes just don't tell the people that, right? Now, we can assume that they might be because we're not exclusive, but a lot of times, dudes and a lot of times women feel like once we start fucking, we become more than just, oh, we dating. Jamie says that's still a relationship if both parties are sexual with others. Right, because most chicks assume that once we start fucking, we got something going on. So maybe that's the situationship, right? Once we start fucking on a regular and dating on a regular, like a date here and there is not, but once we start fucking and or dating on a regular basis, we assume that we got something going on. Now, if you call that the situationship, then okay. But we assume we got something going on. And if the dude never says that he is also dating or fucking other people, we just assume that, like you said, we're still maybe in the we're getting to know each other phase or whatever, but we assume that you're focusing your energy on this particular situationship and where it can go. We don't automatically assume you in five situationships.
This is true. Yes, it's true.
So again, to me, it's really just about like clear communication. And that's why you hear men talk about women and the dreaded question, like, what are we, right?
I was going to say that. And I say that because I've met somebody, I'm introduced to somebody through a friend. And she said she's getting divorced. She wants to have fun with somebody. So when I met her, I was like, heard you got divorced. Heard you just want to have some fun. That's all I'm trying to do too. What's good? Yeah, that's all I really want to do. Then we had sex three times, and I come by smash, and she's like, before you come in, I have to ask you, what's up? Where is this going? I thought just to the bedroom. What are you talking about? Where are we going?
We're just having fun.
Right. We established in the beginning, we were both just trying to have fun. I was out of a bad marriage. You was out of a bad marriage. We were just trying to have fun. We was married. Why is all of a sudden now, where is this going? It's going... I'm about to go back to my car and forget this ever happened. That's where it's about to go.
But for us, for women, I think it's just when it becomes a habit, right? Or when it becomes something that's continuing to happen. Like, you know what I mean? So we might have agreed, yeah, I just want to have fun. But now, 3 weeks later, we've been hanging out. We've been on the phone together. We've been fucking. We've been doing our thing. So now, all of a sudden, we start asking ourselves, where is this going? What are we doing? Like, we start saying to ourselves, okay, I just can't do this forever with this nigga. We can't have fun forever. Like, these are the type of conversations we start having with ourselves, because here's the thing. One of the reasons why we can't is because if we're having fun and just doing the same shit with you forever, we're not going to be able to necessarily meet the guy that actually may want to be with us, because we're focusing our energy over here and what we got going on. Jamie says, I think all parties should assume all parties are sexual with others until there is a discussion of monogamy. I agree.
That sounds very adult.
Right. It does sound very adult. But like I said, ladies, let's not pretend that we don't convince ourselves, you know what I'm saying? That like, he's probably not. We say things like, he's probably not fucking with nobody else because he with me every night. We on the phone. Like, you know what I mean? We just start... In our minds, we just start saying, well, we together like 4 or 5 days a week. You know what I mean? He comes to my house every night when he get off work. Like, we just start adding this stuff up and start assuming he can't have no, you know, be wanting to fuck with nobody else because he's with me so much, right? He does all these sweet things for me. So we don't, you know what I mean? I think we probably in our logical mind know that it's quite possible that he's fucking somebody else, but we convince ourselves that like, he's spending a whole lot of time with me. He's giving me a lot of energy. He's calling me quite often. He's checking in with me. Like, and at this point, we just think that we're just, you know, working towards this whole relationship, when in fact that might not be the case.
Now, see, now this is my thing with that young lady. I was about to say her name. I don't know if I can. This is it. Look, we and her weren't talking on the phone. We didn't go on dates. All we did was have sex.
Now, see, that's different.
And that's why I was like, what do you mean, where is this going? All we've done is have sex. What do you mean, where is it going? What are you talking about?
And to me, it just sounded like she was ready to talk about something different. But generally, when you don't do all the extra shit is when it's a lot easier to keep. But then what happens is, for a lot of women, is now we start to feel like, I don't want to be a sex object, right? I don't want this nigga to only think the only thing he can do with me is fuck me. Because now we're starting to question, like, does this nigga not think I'm relationship material? Does he not want to be with me at all? Like, all he thinks I'm good for is a fuck. After too many just fucks. Now you find yourself at the crossroads where she's saying, hold on. We've reached our maximum number of just fucks in my mind, because I think that maximum number might be different for different folks, right? For her, it was 3. For somebody else, we got to have maybe about 10 fucks before I'll be like, what the fuck are we doing? Like, this nigga ain't never asked me to go on a date. You know what I mean? So then that starts to play with, you know, and society, I tell people all the time, your girlfriends and shit, once you start letting all those people get in your head, and they be like, girl, you said you was fucking with Marcus. We ain't met Marcus yet. Do y'all go out? All this nigga do is drop by and drop off some dick, and that's it. He don't give a fuck about you. So it's like this whole thing we have to play out within ourselves, amongst our friends, everywhere.
Right, but then that's when I think that we shouldn't, like, don't allow other people to determine or dictate whatever it is that you got going on with somebody else. You know what I'm saying? Because from the outside, looking in, it might not look right, I guess, to what others may view, but at the end of the day, you two are the people that have to be to deal with each other. You two have to hold each other to whatever level of standards you want to have, and like it shouldn't matter what other people think. I think it should only matter between the two people that are dealing with one another.
I agree. But once again, like, your friend, when they start asking questions like, girl, you dealing with anybody lately? You still fucking with Marcus? Like, what, you know, it just happens. And whether we want to allow it to or not, quite often, that stuff starts to get into your head, right? You might say to yourself, like,
it's already in your head.
Right, correct, because you're already kind of figuring, Marcus don't never take me out. Marcus don't never, right? And now all your girlfriend comes along and says, bitch, all he doing is dropping off dick. He don't give a fuck. Like, you know what I mean? So it just starts adding up. And that's when we start saying, you know what, right? You right, bitch. I'm going to ask this nigga, like, what the fuck does he want? Because, like, that's what we do.
So the magic question. So from a woman's point of view, right, like, what makes it so important as to what your friends say about what you're doing with your said person? Like, why is what your friend, why is that girlfriend that you just said, why is what she says so meaningful or so impactful to a woman's life as to, like, what this chick say? Like, why does it matter if Marcus is just dropping off dick in that? If you get what I'm saying? I don't get it.
Well, first of all, usually those are, like, your closest girlfriends who are saying it to you. So these are the chicks that have had your back. These are the chicks that have wiped up your tears. These are the chicks that, you know, you can cry and whine and complain to or whatever. So your first thought is, well, they want the best for me, right? And so if they want the best for me, then they're going to always, you know, push me, and they're going to always encourage the best for me, right? So nobody wants to see their friend, particularly if the friend is like, girl, oh my God, Marcus, he's this and he is that. And you start asking questions, and now you're like, maybe my friend's judgment is clouded by the good dick, but she needs to know that, like, this nigga ain't doing nothing but dropping off dick. So now it's like, we're really trying to help you have a reality check. Now listen, if I tell my girlfriend, this nigga ain't doing nothing but dropping off dick, and my girlfriend responds and be like, bitch, I know, but that's all I want from this nigga, then I'll be like, all right, well, let's drink to that, right? I'm not going to spend a whole lot of energy like, you deserve more. Why are you doing that, right? But I think it really comes from, like, how strong-minded and convicted you are within yourself, right? Because even if that's all you want, some women won't admit that to their friends because they don't want their friends to judge them for that being all that they want, right? So a lot of time, you won't even say to your friends, bitch, I ain't trying to be in a relationship with Marcus, just got some good dick. Because you don't want to hear what your friends have to say about you making these bad choices and judging you about this. And it's just, like, I think women, we've always cared about what people have thought about us, particularly Black women. We've always cared about how we're seen and how people have thought about us. We just, I don't know. Now, again, when you get to a certain stage in your life, like, I think it probably has to do, like, when you mature and get older, like, number one, when you get to a certain stage in your life, you don't tell your friends as much shit as you used to when you was younger. That's the first thing. And then number two, you have found yourself and you good with you. So it doesn't really matter what you bitches think. I'm doing me. But a lot of women don't get to that place. One Scorpio says, at a certain stage of life, most women only want to date if it's leading to a committed relationship. I think it's what to say, I hate that. There should be a discussion about, there should be a discussion about monogamy. I have friends who thinks this guy is her boyfriend, but he's seeing others. First Class Boxer says, right, and sometimes your girlfriends are like your reality check, right? Because she just said, I have a girlfriend who thinks this dude is her boyfriend, but he's dating others. So sometimes when you're telling your friends what's going on, your friends will give you a reality check and be like, but bitch, he's not even your man. Like, you know what I mean? Like, we have to be the reality check. Like, well, she'd be like, let me tell you about Marcus. And I told Marcus, we got to be the ones to be like, you can't tell Marcus that, he's not even your man. So sometimes it's like, we just helping you to put things into perspective. Like, you look crazy right now. Don't go up to Marcus's job acting like that, because that nigga's not even your man. Did he ever say he was your man? Like, sometimes it's that, right? Where we trying to help a sister, like, pull yourself together and figure your shit out. First Class Boxer says private life equals quiet life, because once others get their opinion of the relationship, it messes up the flow of what good is already going on. Jamie says girlfriends are your truth barometer. First Class says it's cool to hear suggestions, but communicate it first before your emotions overrule what is really happening. One Scorpio says because your girlfriends are there when you're crying about this dude. Right, because ultimately your girlfriends have to tell you these type of things because they don't want you going to go back crying to when he done hurt her feelings or he done did something or she thought something was something. Sometimes we have to say, bitch, I told you that nigga wasn't trying to be with you. Like, you know what I mean? Sometimes, but if we never give him any warning, you know what I mean? Then it's like, what kind of friend are we? So I think like when you have real girlfriends, like who really care about you or whatever, I feel like they're the people who keep you in reality. And when you say, bitch, I know that's the reality, but I'm good with it, then your girlfriend's just like, well, okay, as long as you know what it is, right? But a lot of times women don't know what it is. they have convinced themselves, because we're really good at convincing ourselves of what we want and how we want it and what we think it should be and how we think we're very good at convincing ourselves of that. So sometimes when we're talking it over with our friends are like, girl, that don't sound like Marcus is your man. It sounds like Marcus is just dropping off dick. It's not necessarily a bad thing to bash Marcus. It's like, girl, what you're describing to me don't seem like what it really is. So it's really just we trying to keep you in reality of what's really going on.
So at the end of the day, it just sounds to me like it's all a relationship, even if you call it a quote unquote a situationship, because it's still some form of a relationship. I think we try to end up complicating things by putting all these extra words and terms and options on it. You know what I'm saying? Nah, we in a situationship, nigga, you in a relationship. You know what I'm saying? Nah, we just fucking, yeah, but it's a fuck relationship. Regardless, it's still a relationship. You know what I'm saying? Period. You know what I'm saying? You can
tell. Yeah, but I think like if you use the right term, then everybody knows exactly what we're talking about, right? So people don't really, sometimes people say we're in a fuck shit, but guess what? If you tell your friends, nah, we just in a fuck shit, then it's clear. Okay, so you're just fucking. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
but that doesn't mean you don't have some type of relationship. But for the most part, when you say we in a fuck shit, that means that we have, at this point anyway, we have no intention on being in a relationship. We're not working towards a relationship. We're not trying to see if we could be in a relationship. We've decided, no, we just like fucking and we fucking, right? We cool and we fucking. So sometimes stating the different relationship types makes it clear, I guess, maybe for others and for you, of where y'all are and what y'all doing. That's why we came up with these terms of like friends with benefits, right? Because you could just say, well, y'all friends, right? Even if y'all fucking, y'all just friends. But no, you add on the little friends with benefits so that people know that y'all friends, but yeah, y'all be fucking sometimes. Mm. James says, people want to put people in boxes. First class boxes says any form of ship has an attachment, but the underlying factors make it what it is.
Yeah.
It's funny we're talking about this because the other night we were watching something on TV and I was talking about a situation. I don't make that face with me. We talked about some situationship that this motherfucker thought was a relationship or whatever it was. And I kept saying, I kept telling her, I'm not your man. Don't get it twisted. I kept saying that so she wouldn't get confused and wouldn't get it, but she kept getting it confused and twisted. So the situationship ended up to where she ended up getting pregnant. All right. So
it was a movie?
No, nigga, this is my life.
Oh shit. Oh my bad. I thought you said y'all was up the other night watching the movie. My bad. I missed. Hold on. Start all over.
No, I told you we often watch TV and then whatever's on TV it triggers a conversation between us.
Oh, I thought he said y'all was watching something. So I'm like, okay, so start. Okay, y'all was up late. You was watching something, and whatever you watching triggered a conversation. Go.
Yeah, and I was telling her, I was like, okay. I'll communicate with you, but if you don't figure out what I'm saying in this vein, my brain goes to the total opposite extreme, which is not always right, but it gets the point across to a degree.
So I'm like, what? So explain. I don't get it.
I'm about to tell you. So I kept
saying, "How trifling he is."
I was, and I'm ready for the judgy eyes. So I'm all ready for it. It's gonna come. This time it's gonna be me getting the judgy eyes, not you. So she's in there having my kid, having a C-section, my black ass in there freaking with the nurse. Telling the nurse in front of her, oh yeah, no, we ain't together. She just had my kid. We ain't together though.
What?
Yeah.
Hold on.
It's just ridiculous. It's ridiculous is what it is. I told him.
Hold on, listen. Now I know your screen paused for a second. I don't know what the fuck happened. So maybe so I missed something in that little bleep when the screen paused. Hold on, wait a minute.
Hold on, wait.
Is it gone?
So when you was having a baby.
Yeah, she was in there having my last kid.
Okay.
They're having a C-section. I'm in there flirting with the nurse, telling the nurse, "Yeah, we ain't together though. But she's having my kid. We ain't together. So what's good? What you doing later on?"
And on that note, I have to pour out the rest of the wine.
Yeah, pull up. Hey, listen. Pour a bottle. Pull a glass for me, and send that shit airmail because I don't even.
Paul, you wouldn't even do no trifling shit like that, would you?
I don't even think I would do no shit like that. I don't. And I mean, I've done some trifling shit in my day. But I don't think I'd do that.
First class, not I want to say you reached a new level of goddamn.
I did. And the fucked up part was she still didn't get it. I told you we're not together. I'm flirting with the nurse in front of you, telling her we ain't together. And you still, so you coming over. Nigga, for what?
Then he took her home from the hospital and left and dropped her off. He wouldn't even stay with her. She just had a C-section. They said she shouldn't be home alone. He was like, it's not going to be me home with her.
Yeah.
Because we're not together.
Because to me, it would just further confuse things. So I took her home, walked in the house, walked in her apartment. She got in the bed. I made sure she had some water by the bed. Made sure she had her phone. And I was like, all right, I'm out of here. I'm out.
But you know she only had that baby because she thought it was going to keep him.
I mean, I don't know all the circumstances. I don't know all the
circumstances. I know based upon what Brian described to me about the whole birth control pet situation, she was trying to get pregnant because she thought that it was going to keep his ass. Anyway.
Yeah, anywho, I'm gonna write this. I promise I'm gonna go ahead and write this book. Y'all go ahead and give me the verbiage that you want me to use. I'm gonna start jotting things down. I'm gonna get the jotting. And yeah, we're gonna put this book out. I think we should do a book first. And then from the book, we should go ahead and get the you know what I'm saying? Go ahead and get
and
the
after
get the
we copyright. Do the book about both of us, then we'll do our separate books about our separate shit. You know, we both right. have some separate shit.
right. Maybe no, actually what you should probably do is y'all should do your separate shit first. Mm. Right? Cause then your separate shit will kind of like tell the story and shape, and then all of a sudden, wow, these two people with these two different types of lives, and then all of a sudden, bow, you hit them with a book together. They be like, wait a minute, they gonna go back and reread your book and his book and be like, well, how the fuck did these? We don't even understand how the fuck it happened. And then when they read the book, and be like, oh shit, you motherfuckers is guest appearances on Oprah and some more shit, and you know what I'm saying? You be guest appearance on our own show. Like, you will be the guest appearance on your own show that you're on right now. Imagine that. You'll be the first time in history that two hosts end up being their own guest speakers. It'll be amazing. It'll be an amazing show. Everyone will tune in. And
well,
I'll be goddamn
my your own book too.
You know, I thought about it.
I want to do like you said. I really want to write a book, but I want to tell somebody else the story and have them write it. That's what I really want. I want a ghostwriter.
You want me to write your story? Because I write shit out.
I want a ghostwriter, for real.
I can write your story.
And it's funny you're saying this, because I had said years ago, I said I was writing a book about my life and I ain't changed none of the names. Ain't nobody innocent in that motherfucker. That's literally what I said. Ain't nobody in my book innocent. So all their names is going to stay in that bitch.
Well, I don't know if you can do that.
I think legally you have to change their names.
Okay, so answer that will be Antonia. I'm not going to
change. What I'm saying is put it this way. It's kind of like, you know what I'm saying? You can, the situations can be exactly the same, right? You just have to tweak the name a little
That's
bit.
What I mean, everyone, I can legally, yeah. Because if you didn't get their permission to like put it in the book legally, yeah. You have to change the name, because otherwise they can sue you for defamation of character.
They can sue you. So with any, any money you make, they'll be right out of your pocket.
Even if it's the same exact situation, you'll be like, well, I didn't put your name in the book, so how do you know this is about you? Like,
how do you know it's you? Nigga, because I know you don't know shit. It could have been somebody else. Shut your mouth. You know what I mean? Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. Answer that's going to be Antonia. It ain't going to be that different. It's going to be different enough.
Okay, well, listen, I was thinking about writing my story.
I've been thinking about writing a book for several years. My daughter, for some reason, she doesn't even know my whole story, but she always periodically says to me, Mom, when you going to write your book? And I'm just like, why am I writing a book? Why do you keep saying that? She, for whatever reason, my daughter's always telling me to write a book.
I got a title for my book already. I know it's going to be cold. I ain't going to say it on the air, but I got a name for my book.
Then I was trying to figure out, like, would my book, like, be a true account, almost like autobiography, or do I want to make it kind of like a storybook where it is about my life, but not necessarily, like, I would change all the characters, including the main character, like, it wouldn't, you know what I mean? I was trying to figure out, like, which angle I wanted to go at.
I guess it all depends on just like anything else, the target audience that you're trying to reach. You know what I'm saying? If you're trying to probably, like, reach a broader audience, is probably just to come out and tell your own story, you know what I'm saying, or whatever. But I get what you're saying. Basically, write a story, but using your life, but not making it about you type
of thing.
Yeah, I get it. So, yeah. Like, you know what I'm saying? Yeah.
So I'm thinking about, I really want a ghostwriter, though. I want someone else to write it. I'm going to just tell you what happened. And
yeah, I mean, that's kind of the easiest thing to do, you know what I'm saying? Or whatever. Or, you know, you can get a recorder and shit, and then just say, you know, chapter one, and just start talking, start telling your story from day one, and put it all recording, and then you can give it to a publisher. You know, and that's what you can do.
When you first start talking, no, all they said was damn. Then somebody's like, well, she was drugged up. She might not even have known what you had said.
She knew, because I reminded her when she got home.
Okay, so I think, so right. So the biggest difference, I think, between relationship and situationship, to sum that up, is it's not a relationship until it has been unequivocally discussed between the two people and you have cleared up that, yes, we're in a relationship. Otherwise, if you haven't done that, then you can you need to consider it a situationship.
That's what it was. I forgot we were watching. We were watching. Whatever we were watching, the dude tried to break up with the female, and she didn't accept his breakup. That's what started this. That's what started that whole thing.
Has that ever happened to you?
She says it's never happened to her.
You tried to break up with somebody and they wouldn't accept it. They just told you, "No, we still together."
Are you? Is that a real fucking question, or was that just some shit that you just?
So when me and Brian were discussing that, I was like, so women, like, for me personally, like, my pride would not allow me to do no shit like that, right? I can't really think of a time I've ever been broken up with. But I just feel like if a dude says to me very clearly, like, "I don't want you no more, it's over, I'm out," then I'm not going to respond back with, "Oh, we still together." Like, no, you don't get to tell me you don't fucking want me. And, like, my pride would not allow it, right? So I'm just trying to understand what kind of low self-esteem women out here is just forcing niggas to stay with them because they said so. Like, what?
I mean, I sometimes I don't know. I mean, I don't even know if it's quote unquote a low self-esteem.
It is because when you think high enough of yourself, no nigga's going to tell you, "I don't fucking want you no more." And you just going to tell him, "Oh, nigga, you want me. You just don't know you want me." What? Like, what?
I mean, you know, I don't know. I don't know, though. Because sometimes, it could just be the fact of, like we all do, we want what we want when we want. And sometimes the mere shock of hearing someone that you like or want to be with telling you, "Nah, nigga, I don't want to fuck with you no more." It can be like, wait, no, it's not over. We can talk about this. We can work this out.
No.
I mean.
Now, yeah. Listen, I can understand what you're saying. I'm never going to say the words, "It's not over." Like, the nigga said it's over, I'm never going to come back and say, "No, it's not over." I may say, "Let's talk about it," just so I can get an understanding of why you want it to be over. But I'm not going to just tell you, like, "I don't accept your breakup."
I've heard all that. "I don't accept your breakup. What are you talking about? We can work this out. We still together. You still gonna be seeing me?" Nigga, no, I won't.
I haven't begged a nigga since I was 14 to be with me that didn't want to be with me. I'm not doing it. Just not.
And I get it. And in my defense, the reason I started coming across like that was because I used to try to be the nice guy and I would try to talk to you through song. So if I wasn't digging you, I would send these chicks nudes and song, "Not my kind of girl." to me, that's a nice way of putting
it. Because if you sent me, be like, "Baby, I sent you a song," and I listen to it and say, "Sorry, you're not my kind," I'm immediately picking up the phone like, "Nigga, why did you send me this song? I'm not your kind of girl now." Like, what? I can't.
And I literally heard her tell somebody, "Girl, he sending me music to listen to. He's still thinking about me." No, I'm not. The song said, "You're not my kind of girl." It even says, "Sorry, you're not my kind of girl."
You know what? But you know what? Here's the thing. And I get what you're saying. But that song is a trick song.
Okay? How was it a song, trick?
Listen, I don't give a fuck who you are, right? Because it's New Edition, first of all, right? And the way the song comes on, Saza, I mean, it, you know what I'm saying? It's the song is so hype that you start dancing and grooving, you start singing the lyrics, and by the time you get midway through the song, you're like, wait a minute, hold up, this song is mean. You're not my type. I don't like you. Right. Get the fuck on. But right. The way they sing it, they have you thinking that it's a love song. But it ain't a love song. It's not even a love song. You know what I'm saying? It's not even a love song. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Jamie agrees with you. She said it sounds like a love song.
Yeah.
So then,
First Class Boxer said he used to do the same thing. He sent that profile liar real quick.
See? And then if that song didn't do it, it was about, I don't know what year it was, but Will Downing had a song called Sorry I. That nigga said, why are you shaking your head? That song didn't confuse you at all. He said, get it, I'm writing this letter to say what's on my mind. First, how are you doing? I hope that you and the kids are fine. I wish I could be there, but I can't. Sorry, I couldn't be what you wanted me to be. Sorry, I. He was like, this is it. It's over. And he said it's sorry over with it. But he was like, I can't do this shit no more.
One Scorpio said all she heard was, you're the kind of girl that a man would be proud to call his own.
That might be true. I couldn't figure it out. I was confused. I'm like, how is this nigga not getting it?
You're the kind of girl
yeah.
that a man
would
proud to call his own. Sorry.
Yeah. You're not my kind of girl.
First Place Boxer said Jagged Edge goodbye on speed dial.
I couldn't fuck with
First Class clearly has a list of songs.
Yes, I have a song for every situation.
You never sent me a song before.
What are you talking about?
When have you ever sent me a song?
What are you talking about, man? Let me talk about it.
Well, you need to start sending me a song every now and then. Shit.
Remember you said that.
Just remember, I'm just as clever as you are.
I ain't worried about that.
Mm-hmm. So anyway, so I think we cleared up the difference between situationship and relationship. Now let's get into this new thing, right? I've been seeing this everywhere. One Scorpio said you should send I Don't Fuck With You. I don't fuck with you. Remember that song? That used to be my song. When I tell y'all, that song was everything to me.
We ain't seen Big Sean since.
But that song itself, man, every time it came on, I'd be like, yes, I don't give a fuck about you or anything that you do. Yes! That song is everything. And I've had to say that to a number of people. Girl, I don't give a fuck about you or anything that you do. Like, to be clear. Yes.
I don't fuck with you. You stupid ass bitch. I ain't fucking with you. It was like
that song just spoke what everybody was thinking, right?
Yeah, it just spoke to your heart. You know what I mean?
Yes, it really spoke to you.
Yeah, it really spoke to your heart. You know what I'm saying? It really spoke to your heart.
And yeah. Brian can tell you, I don't even really like music like that, right? I'm really one of those type of people. I like soft, mellow, you know, slow songs. My playlists are always full of a whole bunch of love songs and stuff like that. But that song right there, I'm about to add that to my playlist. I forgot all about it, and I'm going to add that to my playlist.
Yeah, that shit was, that was. That
Man, was I used to love that song. So funny. Okay. Or the other song I really like, that song that says, fuck this shit, I'm out. I love that song.
I don't even know that one.
I'm gonna send it to you. You just be like, all right. This shit, I'm out.
Sing that to me. I never heard. Who sings that one?
I don't know. I think I saw it on Facebook a couple of years ago, and it was just like, I just remember the words was, fuck this shit, I'm out. I mean, don't you feel like that a lot? You be like, man, fuck this shit, I'm out.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah. Deuces. I'm all right.
So what I've been seeing, I've been reading a lot of articles here and there. And then Brian brought it up today when we were talking. And I was like, you know what? I need to know. I need some answers. I need somebody to make it make sense, right? So the new thing, first of all, two new things. Ethical non-monogamy is becoming more and more popular and bigger around the world. So just so y'all know. But anyway, that's not what I want to talk about. This new notion of getting married or being in a committed relationship, wherever, and you guys deciding not to live together. So right now, this is a very big thing right now. You can tell it because I got to go check on my meatloaf.
So there is a couple in New York. They were married 6 years. They had a rough patch. Wife lost her job. and they decided that they were going to travel around the world to rekindle their relationship and fall back in love again. But she lost her job, and then financially they couldn't do it. So what they decided they were going to do was live in different homes 15 minutes apart in New York City.
Okay.
The wife lives here, the husband lives here, they're 15 minutes apart. They do sleepovers occasionally, but they don't live together, but they're still married. And they said that's giving them the spark back in their relationship. So the popular thing now is getting married and being apart.
I mean, you know, I mean, that's kind of like what I was saying earlier. I think, you know, however you decide that you want to be and, you know, live your relationship, you know, you got to find, you know, the thing about relationships, man, as we get older, there's no quote unquote traditional way anymore for people to interact or be with somebody. You know what I'm saying? I think that's the good part about being in relationships with situations, whatever you want to title, you want to call it, is because you can make decisions like that too. That's whatever's going to work best for you and that person. It's good. I mean, if that's what, you know what I'm saying? If that's what brings about a spark back in your relationship and it's working and y'all stand together, then it is. You know what I'm saying? Now, I guess you're not having, I guess for some people, like the stress of like being in that person's space every day, all day, they live down the street, you know what I'm saying? You're still married, but hey, let me go spend the night at your house and then I'll go back to my place and give each other some room and some break, some time. You know what I mean? I mean,
get it. But my mindset is this: if y'all were already hitting the rough patch and now y'all just separate places, now is your mind be over here saying, oh, she fucking with Ken now. How I know she ain't sleeping with so-and-so because we ain't in the same household no more. How do I know?
Yeah, I mean, this is true, but I mean, hell, you could be, I mean, there's people who live in the same house, you know what I'm saying, and still think the same motherfucking way, and they live in the same fucking house. So it's no different, you know what I'm saying?
At least if you're living together, you got to work a little bit harder to get away with it. If you over there and I'm over here, I can't see shit. I'm just hoping that everybody's staying faithful.
I mean, yeah, I mean, I get that, but, you know what I'm saying? If somebody going to do something, they going to do it. You know what I'm saying? Whether they in the house, out the house, you know what I'm saying, or whatever. You know what I'm saying? Shit. So, I think whatever works for each person, I guess they gotta figure it out for themselves to figure out what it is they want to do and how they want to live their relationship.
Yeah, and Ebony was saying, if that's the case, what's the point of even being married? She said.
But they're saying that marriages are lasting longer if you live separately. So I mean, is that the same? I guess that's not the same thing as having like a she shed, right?
I mean, maybe. I don't know. I mean, what's the? I mean, again, I just think that whatever makes you happy, whatever works for two people, you got to find your own source of happiness. No matter
what.
Like,
what would be the point in getting married if we're gonna just live separately? Like, why can't we just keep doing what we've been doing if we're gonna live separately?
I mean, shit, some people would make the same argument about people who, I mean, I hear the same argument all the time about people who are in poly relationships. Like, if you guys want to continue to go fuck other people, this, that, and third, why even bring a whole marriage into it? I mean, you hear the same argument from time to time. I mean, yeah, it's always going to be, right, so you're always going to hear, you know, mitigating circumstances as to why something could be, but you two do it, and you guys are fucking great. But some people couldn't live the life that you guys live and have the same amount of happiness. You know what I'm saying? Because I guess, you know, again, with you and Brian, you guys check in with each other to make sure, hey, we still good with this? Da, 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 da. You know what I'm saying? So I think whatever rules people set for themselves, you got to figure out.
I think that reason why is because people are a lot more selfish than they want to admit they are, right? Like, we was being totally honest. People are a lot more selfish than they want to admit that they are. So I feel like if a couple decides, you know, because I don't know that I think poly is for everybody, right? Like, I hear women say all the time, like, I have an aunt that always wants to know everything going on with me, and I will come visit and go to the LS parties with me or whatever. But normally, like, nobody would think that that's the type of thing she do because she's, you know. But I have another aunt that is like, oh, I don't share. I don't share. That's her favorite thing to say. I don't share my man. I don't share. So she's never had a threesome. She's never like, I don't share. I don't share. I'm just like, all right. It just sounds super selfish to me, right? And insecure, if you ask me. But whatever. Don't share. That's your business. Hey, can you blow up my eye? Something's a lie. Why are you laughing?
I thought about boomerang.
Something's in my eye.
Ain't nothing was in your eye. Now, see, now that is a perfect example on how being married and living 15 minutes apart could cause a problem. What if you was married and apart and something was in your eye? Now I got to drive 15 minutes to blow some shit out your eye? You know what I mean? That could be a problem.
Yeah, I just thought it to me. Like, it just doesn't seem economically feasible, right? Because now we're maintaining two different houses. Is this nigga gonna, if you my husband, I have certain expectations. Is this nigga coming over every day to take out my trash? Like, I don't understand. Like, it's just certain shit that I'm just like.
I mean, shit. I mean, if you're financially stable to do it, shit. I mean, again, to each his own.
Yeah, but wouldn't it be better for us to combine our finances so that we can do different things that we may not be able to do on our own finance? Like, yes, I can maintain my own household and stuff, but maybe if we combine our finances, we can afford this vacation or whatever. I'm just saying, like, it just seems to me like we're wasting a lot of money because your ass feels like you want to be by yourself sometimes. Yeah, go sit at the bar like every other nigga that was married did.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is, we know we are under the premise that the people that they're talking about don't have the means or the financial means to do it. Like, to us, we'd be like, nigga, that's a waste of money because, you know, we need to whatever. But for them,
but I'm saying that even if you have the financial means, in my mind, it's still a waste of money. It's just a waste of money.
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah, I think I agree in a sense, but I mean, we do know that we as people, you know, that we spend, we waste money all the fucking time. So, that's, you know what I mean?
But don't forget, there was, like I said, she lost her job. That was part of their rough patch. She got a job now. So it's kind of like, yeah, but nah. Like you said, if she didn't find that job and he had to pay for both rents, because first of all, let's ain't nothing cheap in New York. Let's address that.
And then if we have kids, who getting the kids at their house?
Well, I mean, they might swap out. You get them Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. I get them Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Sunday. And then we all be in one house on Sunday as a family and have dinner. Who knows? I don't know. Again, man, you know, it's sometimes it's easy for us to, when we read stories like this, to really, really, you know, it's good that we talk about it because I do want to always want the views and opinions of other people.
Because what the articles that I was reading wasn't necessarily because the couple had any type of infidelity or they had any issues. Like, they agreed from the very beginning, oh, let's just live in our separate houses, you know what I'm saying, and be married. Mm-hmm. Like, so it wasn't, in the case that Brian's talking about, you know, were some infidelity and stuff like that. But in a lot of the articles that I've been reading and coming across, it's just a decision that they feel like we're more happily married in different houses. Now, I will say that there is a such thing as, like, healthy space, right? That's why a lot of relationships got tested and or ended during COVID, right? Because there was not enough, we didn't get enough space from each other. I love Brian and Brian loves me, but we don't want to be together 24/7, 30 days a month.
Right. I think there's always a much needed time apart.
Even if the time is just while you at work, right? What you know for sure is that while you're at work, you're not with each other, right? Because I feel like any people who are together too long for too long amount of time and too long of a span start to get on each other's nerves and start having issues. Even if it's your best friend, you and Brian, Ace, Boom, Coon, we've been seventh grade, we've been rocking. But if y'all had to be together 24/7 for a long stretch of time, you will see some cracks, some breaks. somewhere in there. Because it's just too much. We're just too into it with each other too much. We need a little bit of space.
Probably.
And I think for us, like, it really is probably mostly when we're at work. If Brian and I are home, we're almost always in the same room. We literally are almost, and it's almost like one or both of us feels
guilty. How do you do the heart thing? I don't know. I can't do it. My hands won't work. It don't work. But that is so.
It's almost like one or both of us feels guilty if we're not in the same room. Because, first of all, we all here when they don't got a whole, two and three levels to a house, right? So we literally can see each other from the different rooms we're in. But that was a thing. It actually became a thing a little bit for me and Brian because I don't mind laying in the bed all day, right? It doesn't bother me one bit. If I don't have anything to do, I have no issues laying in the bed all day. I might not be asleep. I have no issues laying in the bed all day. Brian, he can't do that, right? It's too much for him. He makes his body hurt. We first got together. He was up and out the bed 7 o'clock in the morning on his off day. I'm never doing that, right? So we had a little clash because, he wanted to spend time with me or I wanted to spend time with him, but I don't want to sit in the living room. I want to lay across the bed. Well, I don't want to lay down all day. I want to sit here. So, eventually, I think we still don't do it very often, but every now and then I'll just be like, I want to lay across the bed, and that's just what I'm about to do. So either he's going to sit in the living room, or sometimes he'll come sitting here on the couch, because we have a couch and a chaise lounge in our bedroom. So when we're at home, we actually spend very little time apart. I just realized that as I was talking about it. We spend very little time apart when we're at home. So most of our time apart is, I didn't even realize that until Brian, whenever I told y'all he had gotten sick back in March of last year. So he was home for about 2 months, was it? I didn't realize how much I had gotten used to getting my break from him when he was at work.
Mm. When he was home, he was like,
right, so after a while, it was like,
this nigga still here?
When is he going back to work?
Nigga, get up, go.
Because like I said, most of our time is spent together, and I think we've never said it out loud, but I think we feel kind of guilty, like, if we're not together, if we're home, right? So it was like, and I told him, I'm like, even when you're home, like, I feel like I have to entertain you, for lack of better words, right? I feel like I can't be doing other things if you're home, because you need me to be your entertainment, right? So even though I'm technically not doing anything specific to entertain him, it just feels like I'm supposed to be like, so if I had planned on coming home and sewing it, I'll be making up different shit. Some days I'm crafting, some days I'm gonna sew this, some days I'm gonna clean out this closet or whatever. Like, I don't get any of those things done if Brian's off.
I get it.
So I didn't realize how much I needed him to be at work and to have that time away from him until he was home those couple months. And then I was like, oh God, I don't know how much longer this is going to work.
I didn't say it to you. I was like, no, that's not it. I was like, okay, all right, whatever. That is it. I told him that was it.
So yeah. So space, I don't know, two different dwellings doesn't make sense to me, but space is very important. The same way I think that it's important for you to have like your own friends. Like, I don't really understand the whole thing where chicks don't want their dude to go out with their guy friends. Like, that's ridiculous to me. Like, they need friends. They need to go out, and I'm going to be out with my girlfriends. Like, that's healthy shit. But for some reason, a lot of women struggle with that.
Well, sometimes women are under the pretense that if a dude goes out with his friends, that he's up to no good. He's doing some shit he ain't got no business doing. And
especially being a single friend, right?
I was about to say, especially.
Or I've heard women say, that's the friend you used to do your dirt with. So, like.
Exactly. Yup. So then it's like, oh, no, nigga. Oh, is Jerome still single? You can't go out with him. I'm vetoing that shit. You know what I'm saying? Because then you start thinking that, where's veto? There's bitches. So, yeah. So, motherfuckers want to be, oh, wait, hold on. Didn't you tell me back in the day you and Tamika used to go fuck niggas together? And you, so when soon as you be like, oh, well, me and Tamika about it, oh, no, the fuck you not. I think you going to sit in this motherfucker and just play some Uno or something on your phone is what you about to do. You know what I'm saying?
That's terrible. That's terrible. One Scorpio says, I wish mine would go out with us. Me too. Like my ex-husband, I used to tell him all the time, you need some fucking friends, right? Like, and he used to say things like, you know, you're my everything. You and the kids are my everything. And I'm like, that's too much pressure on me. You need to get you some friends. Like, you know what I'm saying? You need, it's unhealthy for you to want me and the kids to be your everything. You need to get you some friends or a hobby or some shit. Like you said, I was wishing this nigga would go find some people to hang out with. It was ridiculous.
Yeah.
So, Brian don't really hang out. But I attribute that more to where we live than the fact that I don't think he would just go hang out with his boys. I just think that, you know, it ain't shit to do in Lawton anyway. But I feel like when we move, that won't be a thing for us.
Have y'all decided exactly where the fuck y'all gonna move to yet? Houston?
Brian, have we decided?
I've decided, but you haven't said yes or no. It's up in the air.
You said, Brian, you have decided?
I know where I want to go. I know where I think.
Where you want to go?
I think it would benefit us to be in Houston, because she's still near her family. I'm near family. And it's more shit to do.
Okay.
I think everybody will be happier.
Okay, well, I mean, it sounds like the Houstons have had it. I mean, shit, that's what it sounds like to me. I think it's going to Houston, Texas. The biggest state in the whole world. Well, it's the biggest as a big state.
In the whole country?
In the state. I mean, in the U.S. You know what I'm fucking saying?
In the whole country.
The biggest state in the United States of America. I mean, that's what they say. Because they say everything is big in Texas.
It is.
That's what they say.
My cousin lives in one part of Houston. We can drive to my aunt's house. The other side of Houston, it's a 2-hour drive. And you're still in Houston. You're still in the same city.
Listen, I believe it. Houston is big.
I want to go to Charlotte, North Carolina.
I mean, Charlotte's not a bad choice either. Charlotte's not a bad choice. Charlotte's not a bad choice. They've really done a lot of shit down in Charlotte. Charlotte is bang bang. I like Charlotte. I like Charlotte.
Yeah, that's really where I want to go. And plus, that will make us both closer to our sons that live in Georgia.
Okay, that would be good. That would be beneficial.
It's a drive to Maryland. It's not that, you know what I mean? If we was trying to go to Maryland, we could just drive if we needed to.
6 hours. Well, about six hours.
We do that now. We do that now to see my so-called family that I'm supposed to be seeing. They're all a 7-hour drive away, except I have a cousin who lives 3 hours away. We don't go see his ass.
Damn, why you gotta say it like that?
I'm just saying, like, so to me, I really want to go to Charlotte. But either way, I want to be somewhere where they have, like, an airport and they have, like, real life happening.
Houston got 2 airports. George Bush and Hobby. They got 2 airports.
I don't know a lot about Houston.
They do. They do. And that one, the one airport is big as shit. It's like a mini city in that motherfucker.
Yeah, I don't know a lot about Houston. The only couple times I've been there, we went like for specific reasons. So we went to meet some of our poly friends once. And then the other couple times we've been there, we just ended up being in the hotel most of the time we was there.
Yeah.
Brian almost got me arrested. Was that in Houston or Dallas?
Dallas.
That was Dallas. You almost got me arrested.
What the fuck was y'all doing to get arrested? Fucking outside. Y'all was fucking outside.
We was fucking on the balcony.
Nasty motherfuckers. Y'all nasty as fuck. Okay?
And the police came. And we were like, oh shit.
Well, actually, his thing. Okay, let me explain the rules for fucking outside so you guys can know your rights. So the police can never try to tell you some shit that you don't know.
I know my rights. Okay, go ahead.
So you can know your rules. You know your rules and know your rights. Okay, ready? Here's the thing. You can get arrested for indecent exposure just as it states if you show your breast or your genitalia, right? So for instance, if I just take all my clothes off and run down the street, my dick is swinging, I can get arrested, you know what I'm saying, for indecent exposure. But if I take, I don't know, a little fucking jock strap or something and put on and run down the same street, but you don't say my dick, and now it's called lewd conduct, right? They'll point you to the side, look, it don't look good. There's some kids out here, you might want to put drawers on. Don't do that. But you can't get arrested for it. Right? Just like if a woman, if she wanna go streaking, right? All she has to do is take something, put it over her nipples. Now this is not indecent exposure because her nipples are covered. Same thing with fucking. So, like if you fucking on a balcony, you fucking in a car, if you right, so if they come to the window and a woman's head is under a blanket or a coat and she giving a nigga head, as long as she don't take her head from under the thing and he sees his dick, it's just lewd conduct. Look, y'all ain't supposed to be after dark. Y'all just move along. It's only bad if they can see genitalia. That's when it becomes indecent exposure. So if you in the grocery store, you can bend your woman over a cart, bang, bang. As long as they don't see your penis and your pussy, you good. Those are the rules. So next time you out there,
was I naked?
Yeah, I was naked.
Butt naked on the balcony, both of us.
Okay, let's be butt naked.
We were all very hot. Like, our floor was super high, so we didn't think that, like, but Brian said it was because I was too loud.
Well, yeah, but they can't. But what you do in your balcony that you pay for is yours. The only thing they can do at that point is say, hey, look, we got kids down there looking up at the balcony, people taking pictures. It could incite a scene or some shit like that. So the only thing they can do is like, can y'all scale it down and bring it on the inside? But you can't be arrested for that. Just as you know, I'm just trying to give you guys your rights of what you can do and what you can't do out in public. Just so you know.
Guess what? Even after the police pulled up, guess what we didn't do? We didn't leave the balcony till we was finished. Like Brian came and then he ran inside real fast and I was like, what's wrong? Because I was so into it, I didn't even notice the police there, right?
I can't do shit. I mean, in that situation, they can't do anything. Yeah, I just wanted to let you guys know your rules and rights and things that you can do and things that you can't. Yeah, just so you know. Just so you right. know.
Because Brian you know what I mean? Said he thinks that we should make Sunday sexy Sundays.
What do you mean?
I hate when he acts slow sometimes. I mean, don't sexy Sunday sound self-explanatory?
Yeah.
You mean on the show? Like, yes. Who was just talking about getting, like, fucking on the balcony, and you talking about sexy Sunday? Like, I don't, what are you talking about? Like, you want everybody to, like, come to the show naked? I don't know what the fuck you're talking about. You know what I mean?
They can do that if they want to. Me and
Brian,
because he was talking about coming on the show without a shirt on.
Oh, so you mean y'all want to talk about sex on Sundays?
No, well, babe, can you give me that over there?
What is that over there?
The juice. Oh, the big one. What's that little one?
The one you've been using?
Is that my blue stick right there?
No, it's not.
Okay, I'm sorry. Intermission.
Intermission, So y'all want to talk about sex on Sundays? Is what y'all talking about?
Well, I mean, I don't know if we can, like, just narrow it down to one day because, as you said, we move with the flow of the conversation. So.
This is true. I mean, this is true. But, I mean, you know, it depends. I think people have a lot going on. Like, I mean, you know, the comment box ain't really lighting up like it normally is. You know, maybe the topic is not as juicy. You know what I'm saying?
Maybe all of our viewers are still there. They just is like, we just want to listen to these niggas talk tonight.
Yeah.
What y'all want to talk about? Do y'all have any juicy questions or topics y'all want to talk about?
I mean, because That's why we always we tell the audience that sometimes you guys can pick a topic, so that way we're not just talking about shit we want to talk about all the time. We can talk about something that you guys want to talk about and get those, you know, get
right?
those conversations.
Because it might not be relevant to them, right? So we just be talking about the shit we want to talk about.
Exactly. You know what I'm saying? We just be like, hey, what we talk about today? I don't know. What we talk about? Then we just come up with some shit. And then we make a show out of it. But, you know, we can always talk about the things that you guys want to talk about. So, okay, well, since we're talking about sex, you know what I mean? Since we're here
subject.
Yet again, where is the crazy? You just going to gulp the shit down like that, though, nigga? Like, you just took it to the head like that? You drank that just now like you was a professional. Like a whole professional. It just seemed like you were. It seemed like you were. Where is the craziest place you and B ever did it at?
The craziest place.
Yeah.
I feel like our answers would probably be different. But so to me, crazy is relative, right? Because you know I'm a wild child, right? So, probably we went here out here. They do a big fireworks show every year at the casino, and people come from all over and they park their cars or whatever, and they watch the fireworks.
Oh, yeah, sex. Yeah.
We decided that was a good time for us to have sex. So.
Outside with the people doing the fireworks?
Yeah.
I mean, was y'all under a tent or anything?
No, I mean, we was next to the car, outside the car.
That's exciting. Did anybody come over and get a gander? I mean, was anyone looking or anything like that?
We don't know. Paul said, where do you think the craziest place we ever had sex was?
Yeah, that'd be a fuss.
But I don't even know if that's crazy, right? I mean,
it's not to us. It's normal. That's some regular shit.
Right. Where's the craziest place? The craziest place I personally feel like I had sex would probably be like at church.
Yeah, I did that. I had sex in church before.
To me, you know, that's like, why did I do that? And it wasn't with my husband. Like, it was. So what's your answer, Paul? They said, how about you, Paul? Where's the craziest place you feel like you've had sex?
The craziest, but I don't know. Because I think every place, anywhere other than the bedroom has always been considered crazy to me. I mean, I've had sex.
Are you serious?
Yeah. I mean, I've had sex.
Anywhere other than the bedroom is crazy to you?
I think. I mean, I've had sex on a roof. Yeah, I mean, I've had sex on a roof. I've had sex at the zoo. I had sex in church. I had sex in an elevator. I had sex in school on the stairwell.
Yeah, that's one thing I never did. I never had sex at school.
Really?
I was never the girl that they was going to say had sex at school under the bleachers, anything nasty like that. They weren't going to be able to say that about me.
Under the bleachers. In the choir room. So I won't know. I mean, you know, at the museum, the Smithsonian, you know, when you were young, you just tried it anywhere.
You just got it where you could get it.
Right, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, because when you were young, you know, you can't, you know, you could do it in the house. But the whole risk of somebody, like mom's coming home and catching you, it just seemed too much like a death sentence. You know what I'm saying? So you're like, oh, let's not do that. So when you young,
that you could get caught by somebody at these public places and then they have to call your mama and tell them. But all right. One Scorpio says sex at the gym office.
She said GYN.
Oh. Okay.
Wow. Well, I want to know, was it her doctor? Did her doctor come in there and be like, you know, not only am I going to give you this exam, I'm about to give you this wood? Like, damn.
It's the two for one.
He said Keith didn't get the syrup.
Is Doc doing that shit now? Like, can you do that?
Yeah, well, you know, they're always accusing GYNs of, like, doing stuff like that to their patients.
Like, I mean, well, doctors, can't you, like, lose? You can lose your whole license for that kind of shit, right?
Like, I mean, but it's only, like, if they come, because a lot of times, it depends on the state, and it also depends on, like, if the person actually tells, that kind of thing. And sometimes they were, like, putting them to sleep and doing it, so the women would wake up and they would feel like, I feel like something ain't right, something happened.
They had their drawers on backwards.
Right, stuff like that, but they couldn't really prove it. One Scorpio said she was dating a resident. Now listen, almost every job I've had, except for the one I'm at now that I think about it, I've had sex at my job.
You in WPN?
Yeah.
I don't know.
How the fuck you ain't know? You fucked me at WPN. What are you talking about? I'm positive. You ate my pussy in my office. Yeah.
Whoa. Hold on. Slow down. Tell the story so the audience can hear. I heard
the comment I made was almost every job I've had except for this one I'm in now, I've had sex at my job. And he gonna say, oh really? Even WMPN, which was the job I had here before this one I have now. And I was like, yeah. He's like, really? That's interesting. What are you talking about? Why is it interesting, nigga? It was you. You were fucking me in my office. You ate my pussy in my office. Like, you know,
oh my God. See? That's nasty. Y'all are so nasty.
She got a door.
Yeah, I was going to say, almost every job I've had my own office, right? So I just been able to close my door and do what I wanted to do. And I did. So, in the times that, like, when I lived in Maryland and I wasn't in a committed relationship or whatever, it would always be, like, at least one person at my job that I'd be like, well, I like him, and I would end up fucking him with the job. I liked it. It was exciting. It was fun. We would sneak off and have sex or whatever. Yeah, it was fun. It was fun. And I remember my last job in Baltimore, I worked at Keswick Multi-Care Facility, I think it's called. We can't say the name of it? Oh. Well.
Oh, well.
You've never done that? You have your own office on the fourth floor? Well, you should try it once, Scorpio. It's very exciting. And anyway, there was a maintenance guy that worked there. We used to always kind of flirt here and there with each other or whatever. And then one day he was like, I need you to help me get something from the storage or whatever. So I go with him to the storage. We had so much fun in that storage room. And then after we established that one time in the storage room, we would just kind of always like sneak here in my office or wherever we decided to go to sneak. But yeah, every job that I've had, either I had a man and he would come to my job and fuck me, or there would be somebody that, when I worked at Coppin, it was this little young boy too. He was so cute.
Oh my goodness.
He was of age, but he was only like 21.
That's not of age. How old were you?
I don't know. I was in my 30s. So he was super young for me. But he was such a cute.
So you let the little young dude just come in there and just get it?
What did I tell you? What did I tell you about young boys?
Okay, I want to talk about that because we're gonna get to your life. We're gonna get into your little bone collection and all that.
Why are younger females the same way as young guys?
I don't know.
Frustrating as hell.
What happened now?
What was the question? He said, "Why aren't younger females the same way as young guys?"
What do you mean?
I guess they don't fuck you like they got something to prove. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Because we're the young ones, right? So the difference is, like, first of all, most women are not, like, fucking the dude. The dude is fucking them, right? So, and when you're young in particular, you're not usually as aggressive or super aggressive or whatever. So you're fucking me. I'm not fucking you. You're fucking me, right? So
you can fuck me back aggressively. What are we talking about?
Anyway, I don't know anything about that. And I love that little boy. And you know what's funny? What's funny is at the time I was still using my married last name. And he always called me Miss Custis, right? He never called me Ebony. He never called me. He always called me Miss Custis. Even after we started fucking, it was always, well, how are you feeling today, Miss Custis? Or he would call me on my office phone, Miss Custis, I think I need you to assist me with something in my office. Okay, I'll be right there. Right? Mm. Like, so, and it's so funny because, I, you know, I feel like people around us were always trying to figure out, like, are they fucking? Because we always just had this flirty little thing, and he would always just be like, well, okay, Miss Custis. And it was so, like, after we started fucking, I was like, you know, but I was kind of turned on by the fact that he called me Miss Custis.
It was a whole problem for people. A whole problem. A whole problem.
So, but, you know, for him to be as young as he was, like, he was already the director in his department. He had custody of his son. And so, like, I spent time in his house. And, you know what I mean? We actually ended up becoming a whole situationship.
Oh, my God.
We did. We actually ended up becoming a whole situationship. And so, anyway. You know, I'm kind of, what's funny is I was having a conversation with somebody the other day, right? And they were talking about, they knew me when I was young, so they knew a lot of the different guys that I dealt with. So he would be like, so you and Kirk were y'all? And I was like, well, Kirk wasn't my man. Well, you and so-and-so, well, he wasn't my man. And so he was like, so who was your man? Like, and I was like, well, technically, I probably can only say I've only had three people that I would say were my man, and Brian is one of them. Because again, if we don't have a discussion and establish me in a whole relationship, you're not my man, right? So so I started thinking about that, and I was like, I guess I've had a lot of situationships. I haven't had a lot of relationships, but they all almost turn out to be situationships because I told you they don't really ever want to go away. And, like, I'm dope as fuck, so, like, who wants to stop fucking with me?
Oh, my God.
Right? Because here's the thing. I'm probably one of the very few chicks that will fuck you and then help you try to fix your relationship, right? So.
Now you take that young man and you go home with that, okay? Put that in your book bag. Tomorrow's lesson is, you funny.
No, seriously, like, I'm probably one of the very few females that will fuck the shit out of you and let you fuck the shit out of me, and then we can talk about what's going on in your relationship, and I'll give you pointers and help you try to figure out, you know what I mean, how you can fix things at home.
You said, I will fuck the shit out of you.
Then I said, or let you fuck the shit out of me.
Yeah, you said you changed it, but yeah, y'all can't fuck up. I know y'all can't.
See, when Scorpio says, I can relate, that's how come, Paul, I keep telling you. I could do the side chick class because not like toot my own horn, but really what ends up happening is I think a lot of guys like see me as just like one of the guys because we're gonna talk regular, you know what I mean? Don't give me this bullshit. Like, even when you and I talk sometimes, I gotta be like, Paul, cut it out. Like, you know what I'm saying? Nigga, it's me. Like, you know. I'm not these regular, these other regular chicks. Like, nigga, I see right through what we're doing right now. Let's get really, let's get into it. So, yeah. But yeah, workplace sex. So do you think that, how many of y'all watching, or even you, Paul, what do y'all think about workplace sex? Are you one of those people that's like, I don't ever, you know what I mean, deal with people that I work with because, what did the girl say? I watched something and she was like, I don't eat where I shit or something like that. Shit where I eat, something like that.
Yeah. People always say that.
Well, I don't mix business with pleasure. Are you one of those people that, like, you wouldn't like fuck the secretary at your job or whoever you hired at your job or whatever?
Not at my job. But I mean, I'm not gonna say that I've never had sex with somebody that I work with. I mean, that's different. I mean, it's just.
So you don't make it a rule like to not fuck your clients' parents or whatever family members, like.
No, I don't. No. That's different. That's different. You know what I'm saying? Because that's fucking with your money. You know what I mean? That's fucking with your money. You know what I mean? But like other jobs that I've had, yeah, like why not? Like who gives a shit? You know what I'm saying? But when it's what, like, but when, but. The gym shit, like, nah, like, Nah, because you know motherfuckers be trying to blast your ass on Instagram. Do you know this motherfucker? Nah, we ain't having none of that shit. You know what I'm saying?
And now, you always felt that way, or you learned the hard way not to do that?
No, when it came to, I just, when it comes to that, you know, you know, there's a very fine line you got to walk when it comes to that shit. You know what I'm saying? Between business and professional.
What about, I know you probably had situations where, like, you was fucking with her already. Y'all was fucking or doing y'all thing. And then she was like, I'm going to bring my son up there for boxing lessons. Has that ever happened?
Ironically, no.
Really?
Ironically, no.
That's interesting.
Ironically, no. Because by that point, you know what I'm saying? If it got to the point where we stopped fucking, then most motherfuckers are like, well, I don't want to be in your face.
No, I'm not. So, I'm not even saying that y'all necessarily stopped fucking. Like, you started fucking with somebody or whatever, and then you end up telling them, yeah, I own a boxing gym, I do classes or whatever. Because I feel like I'm the type of chick that, like, if the dude I was fucking with owned a gym, I would probably try to support his business and shit. So you've never had that?
Nope, I told you before, nigga. Listen, I got a whole gym, and all we just had this conversation a couple weeks ago. I had a whole gym, and you know when you post things or whatever like that, like a lot of people that I know for a fact have children, they don't bring their fucking kids in,
or they don't themselves go take a class. Like even if I didn't have kids, I might be like, let me go support my boo. I'm gonna take this class at his gym. Like
I mean, some people have, but most people who I know they got kids. They don't bring their kids to the gym and go, hey, can you train my kid? They don't do it. They don't.
One Scorpio says, I don't get my meat where I make my bread. Okay. Listen. Now, I do think, so I'm the kind of person that, like, I never tell people that you shouldn't get involved with somebody you work with. But I do tell them that you need to know the person for a little bit before you do, right? Because there's a certain level of maturity that has to exist in a person for you to fuck with them and work with them. Because as Paul just said, if we stop fucking with each other for whatever reason, you're not going to fuck with my money and I'm not going to fuck with yours, right? And so you have to know that the person has a certain level of maturity before you fuck with them. Or else you're going to have a lot of problems. Mm-hmm. And I don't want everybody in my business, right? So you got to also know this person is not about to tell everybody they know we fucking, right? So to this day, nobody really knows that me and that boy were fucking. They all just speculate. And every now and then, if I run into somebody that I worked with there or whatever, they'll be like, how is so-and-so doing? And I'll be like, I don't know. I haven't talked to him. For a little while, we would like, once a year maybe, we would like catch up. Because that was, like you said, back when we had like Yahoo Messenger, we would talk through like the Gmail little messaging thing. So every now and then he would like pop up in my Gmail messenger thing and I'd be like, hey, how are you? Whatever. But people are still speculating on what they think might have happened between him and I. But, you know, so you do have to make sure that the person has a certain level of maturity and can handle that type of thing. You can't just jump on the first nigga or the first chick you see with a fat ass at the job. Like that's going to be a lot of problems for you. Did you have workplace romances?
Yeah,
I've had a few.
I'm 49. I've had 30,000 jobs. What you mean? Yeah.
And how did they all go well?
Most of them did. The last one didn't. The last one got ugly. I had to allegedly. So what happened was, she started working. I was a bus driver. She started working at Depot, driving a bus. She was hanging out with me and this dude, Kirby. She used to hang with me and Kirby. Exactly. Yeah, that nigga.
That nigga. Don't talk about Kirby. No
shit. Yeah, he doesn't talk about. Yeah, so. Me and Kirk would go to the bar on Friday night. He invited her to come hang out with us. I didn't invite her. She came. She was feeling me, apparently. He thought she would be feeling him, but she was feeling me. I ain't had nothing to do with that. I was like, you got a man. I was like, so it's cool. You got a man. I ain't thinking about you. Just do your thing. Do whatever you do. I'll buy you drinks, whatever. I'm buying you a drink. She called me one night. I was at the bar saying her and her boyfriend broke up. She wanted me to come by. So I went by. We smashed. It was terrible.
Like, he didn't know what he was going by for.
I knew, but I'm saying it was terrible.
Okay.
The sex was terrible?
Why was it terrible? Yeah, the sex was terrible.
The sex was terrible.
Why? What makes sex terrible to y'all? Like, was her pussy dry? Like, I don't understand. Short of her pussy being dry, what makes it, or her pussy being too loose, as y'all say, what else makes it terrible?
She had no self-confidence in herself. How are we trying to fuck you trying to keep your bra and panties on? I mean, the panties I pulled to the side, but I'm like, yeah, let them titties go. They got to be free.
That's what made it terrible, because she wouldn't.
I said starting.
Okay, so she wouldn't unleash her titties. Then what happened?
She had no confidence in herself, so she was fucking like she was timid. And she might not know what she was doing. I don't know, but she had a kid, so I figured you had to know something. You ain't changed your first. Changed your first rodeo. So anyway, she was just there.
Oh, okay.
She was just there.
So she laid still, like a.
She laid still. She was dead quiet.
Oh, no noise either.
No, yeah, it was trash. I'm telling you.
But couldn't the pussy have still been good, even with all of those variables?
Yeah, no. The confidence now.
So hold on, pause. Let's unpack that a little bit. He said, yeah, but with no confidence is a no. Is that right, Paul? Or do you agree that, like, when you're fucking a woman that doesn't exhibit any type of self-confidence, that can fuck up the whole experience?
Yeah, I just think that the energy that the two people have, that you have with that person, will help add to or take away from the sex that you're trying to have. You know what I'm saying? So let's just say I kick in the door, waving the fofo, like, and I'm trying to be Mr. Freaky Man, and then you're like, wait, what are you doing? I don't even, wait, the fuck? Or, perfect example, let's just say you laying there with a woman, you watching TV, you know what I'm saying, or whatever, you laying your head in her lap or some shit like that, and you know, most women usually, not all, but some women start rubbing your shoulders, rubbing your head, you know what I'm saying, shit start feeling real good, right? At that moment, if I pull your motherfucking pants down and I start trying to suck on something down there, don't stop, be like, wait, what are you doing? What do you mean, what am I doing? What do you think? What do you think is about to happen right now? I don't even understand. What do you mean? Like, what are you talking about? Like, what?
That's like I always say, at that point,
you know what's about to happen.
And how do you think? She didn't initiate anything. She was just being affectionate and loving.
I understand that. Listen. I'm a firm believer of this, and I mean this shit, okay? Women, if you're listening or tuning in tomorrow, listen to this, what I'm saying. I think right now we all are of an appropriate age, and we have all led appropriate and different lives. That's fair to say, correct?
Mm-hmm.
But I think we're at the age now that, like, come on, man. We not teenagers. We not in high. You understand what I'm saying? Like, you know what happens when two motherfucking adults get the fuck together. You know it's going to be some furniture moving around that motherfucker, some pants coming down, some panties around your head, legs in the air. You understand? Like, stop with this narrative. Like,
can't she do that just to be, like, coy and cute? Like, to act like, yeah,
she's
not stopping you. She's just being like, what are you doing? Like, she's
not. Fuck that. Listen, you ain't a fish. Stop being coy. You know what I'm saying? Fuck all that shit. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, stop acting as though
right.
You don't know what it is.
Hold on, Paul. I think you just shined a light on something that might be an issue for us, right? Because I just said to Brian, I was like, I do that sometimes. And he was like, yeah. Like, nigga, what? You don't like it? You could have told me you don't like it. Like, what?
No, what I'm saying is, like, don't get me wrong. Like, if we role playing, like, for instance, like, say, like, we role playing, right? Like, check it out. All right. You know, you go to the grocery store. or you go to the bar or whatever, and I'm like, hey, what's up, baby? How you doing? You know, you do that little shit. You're like, I don't even know you. You know what I'm saying? You do that shit, then I get it.
Right.
But like,
when I do that to Brian is because, like, he'll catch me off guard. Like, the other day, I'm in the kitchen. I'm trying to put the chicken in the oven, my nigga. Like, I'm just, we literally was just in the same bedroom chilling. He was laying across the bed. I was sitting on the couch. We was in the same bedroom chilling. He gets up. He goes to the bathroom. I get up. Let me go put this chicken in the oven before we start the show, right? Okay. I'm trying to wash and season the chicken. Here he come. I said, well, what are we doing?
listen. So it's like, okay, like, right, you was laying in the bed, you was chilling, right? He went to the bathroom and he said, you know what? Bat dick activate. You went in the kitchen, you start seasoning that chicken, and he was like, you know what? That chicken gonna be delicious. Let me thank her for seasoning this chicken properly. Did you see the way she lift that chicken and turn that chicken around? It's seasoned under the bottom of that motherfucker.
Like, I'm like, what?
Listen.
Like, you picked the most inopportune time. So anyway.
No, it's not. No.
Because when he first comes in the kitchen, he just kind of standing there kind of looking at me. But you know the look where you're looking like, this nigga's looking like he wants to eat me up right now, right? So I just kept moving around or whatever. I bent over in the kitchen, put his dick on my butt. You know how y'all do that?
Yeah, exactly. as well he should have. Like, listen, what you not going to do is lay in this bed with me all fucking day. They want to get up and go do some wifely duty and that thing that I'm going to bring this dick airmail into the kitchen with you because you about to get this work. The fuck you mean?
I'm like, well, Brian, just let me finish seasoning the chicken.
Listen. You can season that chicken after I season this ass with this dick. That's what the fuck you can do. That's what you do. Fuck that chicken. Get this work. Brian, did you give it a work? Did you give it a work? You damn listen, right you did. You damn you know right.
Said, sex in the kitchen, over by the stove.
Sex in the kitchen, over by the stove. Oh, nigga. And you know what? She wasn't even making rolls, but I bet you buttered that biscuit. Now, did you, my nigga? Yeah.
Now, the only disadvantage listen, is I told y'all I don't wear panties. And I told y'all around the house I'll be even having on a lot of clothes. So he like, yeah, go ahead and do what you got to do with the chicken. Next thing I know, it's a dick in me, right? I'm like,
I mean, what the fuck? I mean, listen, you know, that doesn't even make any sense. You walk around with no drawers on. You've stated on many shows that it would be real hard pressed to find you in clothes at all, period. You said it's a struggle for you just to put clothes on to do the fucking shows that we do. You land there with this man all day in the bed. Butt ass naked.
In my mind, hold on. Had all day to be nasty.
Nah. Fuck that. No. Fuck that. Brian wanted your ass when you was in the kitchen seasoning the chicken. That's the opportune time. Bend your ass over. Put your hands on this motherfucking stove. Let's get this work. Yeah. Temperature. Listen. Hey. Temperature just went up a notch, huh? Temperature on high, yeah. Huh?
So that's yeah. How come a lot of times, that's how come a lot of times he'll get my, wait, what are we doing? Wait, what's that? Okay, is this what we're doing? Because yeah, he always catches me so off guard. I'm like, what? I'm in the hallway looking in the closet. And he, why are you here?
what the fuck? What do you mean, why am I here? I'm here, hello. I'm here to deliver the dick. Hello, Amazon package coming in. Bow. Huh?
I just don't know why he cannot do it.
Yeah.
I told him he's so
you priority mailed that dick, didn't you, my nigga? Hey! You priority mailed that dick, huh? Amazon package. It is.
One Scorpio in the case, we was in the hallway, nobody was home. But in the case of me being in the kitchen trying to get the chicken in the oven, the kids was in their respective bedrooms, right? So I said to him, I said, Brian, I said, what are we going to do with the kids coming? He said, I'm going to run into the laundry room. You going to just leave me here, kids trying to figure out why I'm butt-ass naked in the kitchen? He like, yeah, I mean, you explain.
You explain that. That's your job, okay? Listen, his job was to deliver the dick. Your job is to come up with the explanation as to why you got dick in the kitchen. Bam, there you have it, okay?
Well, needless to say, I was like...
And if the police showed up, I'm there
for a minute
to be y'all attorney.
Let's go in the room. Fuck that chicken. Huh. Let's go in the room.
Fuck that chicken. Fuck that chicken. The chicken is good. What?
I said fuck that chicken. And so now the children didn't even get to eat till we finished the damn show.
Hey, listen. Sounds like, that sounds like a clear case of what you said the other show. Fuck them kids, okay? Fuck them kids. We got some grown folks shit to do up in here, you hear me? Fuck them kids. You know what I'm saying?
That's what I'm saying. So lack of confidence can ruin the whole sexual experience for y'all.
Yes, because this is the thing. You call me, I'm at the bar. You tell me to come by. You know I'm at the bar, so the bar closes at 1:30. So you know I'm coming to about 1:30, 2 o'clock. Why is there a question? What's going to happen? We can't go from here. You laugh. TV on your hand on my shoulder, your hand falls on my lap. They didn't touch my dick. Now you think it's just going to be, oh, okay. That was an accident at 2 o'clock in the morning. Nah. And then this whole, what are you, it's the thing when you say, what are you doing, and you mean that shit, it's like, what the fuck do you mean, what am I doing? I know you're playing. I know you're joking to a degree. But that's serious. Wait, what are you doing? What do you mean what I'm doing? You know what I'm doing. This is the whole reason why you called me, right?
Exactly.
So why are you asking what I'm doing?
Again, all I'm saying is
because we want a little bit more romance, a little bit more kissing and hugging and touching, a little bit more foreplay before you just act like you're about to just, I'm getting into it. Like, you know what I mean?
I'm not talking about the foreplay. I'm not talking about the kissing and all that. We can do the kissing, we can do the foreplay, we can do all that upset. What I'm saying is women have to take responsibility sometimes for your own fucking actions. Be a grown ass motherfucking adult about the situation. Don't sit up here. Don't motherfucking sit up here. You know what I'm saying? Like, for instance, like, don't go to fucking dinner with me, be dressing all fucking sexy, right? And then I'm looking across at you like this, like, listen, nigga, stop. Look at me like that. Man, listen. Fuck. You gonna keep looking at me like, and then act like you not supposed to get Amazon dick package delivered to your motherfucking doorstep. Don't do that. The fuck you mean, nigga? You know what I'm saying?
Okay, stop so playing. I have fat issues. I
stop
have fat
playing. Issues. The fuck?
Hold on. I'm trying to understand this chick, you know what I mean? I have fat issues. So every now and then, you know what I mean, my fat issues, you know, might get the best. Not really with you. I mean, I really probably only have fat issues like the first time I fucked the person, right? Because this is the first time they really are going to get to see all of me, right? After that, it's like, nigga, you knew what you signed up for when you got here, right? So after that first time, I'm good. But every time, you know, you have sex for the first time with somebody, you know, you have to start, you can have like these insecurities, like, oh, he's about to see my stomach, and oh, he's about to see, you know.
And I can even get that, because she wasn't a small chick. But I'm just saying, if that's gonna be the case, nigga, apparently you got big teeth. Put a big t-shirt on. Raise back in that motherfucking t-shirt, we ain't got to worry about nothing. We all good. Everything's going on.
Yeah, I'm saying, like, all I'm saying is, listen.
Amazon, you like to have sex in the dark, or you want the lights on?
Excuse me?
Do you like to have... I hate when you do that.
I didn't hear what you said.
Do you like to have sex in the dark, or do you want the lights on?
I don't give a fuck about no lights. Lights, dark, candle, fucking flashlight,
exactly.
Phone light. I don't give a shit. Listen, as long as we about to get it in, nigga, I don't give a... Flashlight, light, daytime. Listen, anytime is a good time to get it in. You know what I'm saying? I don't get
So you don't care about the lights being on or off. A lot of women, do y'all care about the lights being on? I actually think I prefer them off.
It just depends. Like, who gives a shit? Listen.
I just told you why. Because, like, if you have insecurities or whatever, when the lights are off, you feel more comfortable.
Listen. Okay, I get it. Okay, ready? Check this out. Ready? I'm speaking to ladies in this situation. Ready? Let me speak to ladies. How do I put? I don't even know how to put this shit delicately. Really, I don't. I don't even. I don't know how to do it delicately. But like, listen. At that point, like Brian said, right? You gotta understand something. At that point, we just don't give a fuck. At that point, you know what I'm saying? Like, we don't give a no offense, but we don't give a fuck about your insecurities. We don't give a fuck about your stomachs. We don't give a fuck about the scars on your body. We just don't give a shit at that fucking point. We don't give a fuck. You know what I'm saying? Because by this time, we've already talked. There's already been some kind of liking shit there, right? You get what I'm saying? Yeah. So, like, at this point. And I figured
that, like, you have to have at least an idea of what we look like under our clothes, right? You
can look at the body shape of the woman and tell. Like, no one gives a fuck about that. Listen, at that point, the only question that needs to be answered is what? And if you've watched my show, you know what the question is. What's the question, Ebony? Right, what's the question? Are we fucking or no? Like, that's what I want to know. Like, who gives a shit about your scars on your belly? I don't give a fuck. Does that pussy get wet? That's what I want to know. Is your pussy wet? Is it getting wet? Have I made it? Oh, can I get it again? Like, I don't, scars, belly.
So men really don't care about stretch marks and stuff like that.
For what? What the fuck? I don't give a fuck about your stretch marks. Because the stretch marks might lead me to where I'm trying to go anyway. It could be like a map to your pussy. Who knows what it is? I don't give a shit what it is. Let's go. Stop playing with it. You know what I'm saying? Stop playing. You know? Like I said, I'm just saying, if you go, like, listen, if we go to dinner, you want to sit across from me, you want to have a little tight shit on, looking like a whole superhero, then listen, I'm going to be the villain. And I'm going to fucking take it. I'm going to get it. Stop playing. You know what I'm saying?
What's
we go to breakfast.
Some
we
men
no, they don't.
Listen.
No, they don't. No, they don't. No,
they probably got something to do. But it's like Cat Williams said. And people take Cat Williams however you want to. I love him. Dude's hilarious.
He is.
He put it perfectly. All stretch marks mean to most men is you was a chick that was big once.
And got you was big and you lost some weight or you gained some weight. That's all the fuck stretch marks mean. Listen, I got stretch marks in my motherfucking shoulder, right? You hear me? And I got stretch marks in my hip. When I was bigger, when I got a little bit smaller, I got stretch marks. I got stretch marks in my motherfucking hips. It don't matter. Are we fucking or no?
Jamie said they might care out in the streets like on the beach.
Well, see, you know, here's the thing.
Let me address that one. Let me address that one.
Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead, B.
If we already fucked, I don't care. We're at the beach. It ain't stopped me from fucking you before. Why is it going to stop me again later on?
Because now other people are seeing us. And Paul reminds us all the time about how y'all get judged by the woman you with.
Not by her stretch marks. The woman.
Listen, all I'm saying.
Whether she's a baddie, is she a baddie?
I mean, but when you go out in public, that's more usually, and I'm gonna be usually the woman. That's when, to me personally, women start feeling a little bit more self-conscious about their bodies and shit like that when they are out in a public setting, like at a beach or some shit like that. When you got these little young girls walking around with these bikini on, asses all the fuck out. That's when sometimes if you're an older woman, you start feeling like, damn. And you start looking at your man like, damn, I know you want that shit. Because a nigga will glance over and be like, okay, I ain't going to lie. That bitch do got a little, she got a little fat ass on her, babe. You know what I'm saying? But, you know what I'm saying? But what people don't understand is that chick, you give that bitch 15 years, she gonna be having stretch marks too. So all that shit is temporary. You get what I'm saying? It's just temporary. You feel me? So it looks good. I'm not saying the shit don't look good. I'm never gonna say that shit. But what I'm saying to you is it's not going to stop a man from giving you the dick. It's just not.
Jamie said you might be embarrassed to have a girl like that on your arm.
No.
Now that some men will,
yeah.
Some men might, but at the end of the day, like I said, if so you were already
men, at, she was good enough.
What
to
I'm
fuck,
saying is,
but I don't want her.
What
to
I'm saying is, but what I'm saying is, if we're already at the beach, you understand? If you're already at the fucking beach and you've already agreed to go to the beach with this woman at that point in time, what are you embarrassed for? You know what her body motherfucker looks like before you agreed to go on the beach. If you was that embarrassed, you'd be like, nah, baby, I don't think a beach trip is the best trip for us. Let's do like a winter cabin shit where we can put on a whole snowsuit and no one knows any fucking thing. Right, but if you...
Or let's go to Kings Dominion instead.
But hold on, but I need to know. So why is it like you didn't care when you were fucking her, but you might care to take her to the beach?
I'll tell you no. why I care.
That's my point. That. Go ahead, Brian.
If I'm claiming you as my woman, we good. If you ain't my woman, you ain't gonna be on my goddamn arm. That's my point.
That's my point. So my point is, I'm not saying that, oh, she's only good for the bedroom. But what I'm saying is, if we've already agreed to go on this trip to the beach, I'm telling you, that's verification to telling you, I don't give a shit. That's why we're going. I don't give a fuck. You see what I'm saying? Like, I don't care. You know what I'm saying? That's what I'm saying.
So basically, you're saying that just because we're fucking doesn't mean that we're in a situationship for me to take you out on my arm. So you can be good with just fucking them, but you never plan on making them your woman anyway. So that's why you're not taking them out.
No, what it just again, what I'm saying, it just depends on who you are. It just depends on who you are. What I'm saying is, if you're in a relationship with somebody and you agree to go to the beach with this said woman, then it's like, it's not about me being embarrassed about you, what you look like, because you're already, at this point, you're already my lady, so we're going to go out, we're going to have fun, fuck who's on the fucking beach, it is what it is. You see what I'm saying? That's my point I'm trying to make. You know what I'm saying? Now, yes, of course, there are some women that, yeah, you might just restrict them to some activity, you know what I'm saying? You might not want to be out there with them like that. You might not be like, nah, I'm not going, no. You know what I'm saying? Like, no, we're not going to do this, not outside. Are the lights on? Wait, what do you mean? Wait. The sun is up. No. The sun is up. You can't do that.
Well, then why did you fuck him in the first place? Huh?
What? So you had her hitting on your arm that she just slept with?
Okay, because
every nigga but one. And I told you about the one. Every nigga but one that I've ever gave some pussy to, I would be okay if someone saw us out in public.
Well, that's you. That's not me. That was not.
Because I told you, I can't fuck with dudes that I'm not physically attracted to. Right?
We didn't say we're not physically attracted to them. Nobody said that.
Paul literally just said, "You want to go out in the daylight? Is the sun out?" Like, that's saying I'm not physically attracted to you. What?
No. Okay, I mean, it just depends. Like, okay. All right. So, all right. Now, all right. So check this out, right? Because I was having a conversation earlier about this, right? So here's the situation, right? And let this shit be clear to every fucking woman in America, everyone listening in, and everyone who will listen later, okay? This is real shit, and this is facts, okay? I was having a conversation earlier with someone, and I was saying to women, and I was basically saying, like, when back in the day, and even now, right? When men go out to the club, right? Go out, right? The only mission that you have for going out is fuck it. That's your mission. That's your goal. You go to a club. That's your goal, right? You can listen to music at home. You can listen to music in the car. You can listen. You might want to hang out with your boys and go have drinks and shit like that. I'm not saying that that's not. But the main mission and the main goal is you go get your hair cut. You trying to look fly. You ain't trying to look fly for the niggas in the club. Oh, nigga, I'm trying to look fly for that nigga over there against the. No, you're trying to look fly because you're trying to catch the eye of a woman. That's the whole fucking purpose. That's the whole fucking point of going out. So there's been times, yes, I've gone out to clubs back in the day, not now, but back in the day, I've gone to clubs, right? Brian, he might not admit to it, but I mean, come on, You go out to the fucking club, right? You looking across, you trying to holler at somebody, and the woman that you trying to holler at, she ain't feeling you that. It's just not your night. It's like playing the lottery. You just don't get a winning ticket every night. You don't get the number. You don't get the number, right? But you, when the lights come on, you start picking out stragglers, right? You're like, listen, I'm not about to motherfucking go home empty-dicked. I'm not going home empty-handed. Like, I didn't cut my hair. I didn't shave. I didn't put on my fine clothes. I'm not going home empty-fucking-handed. So the lights come on, and then you start picking out stragglers, right? So then, like, I'm walking out, and then there was this girl. Like, you know what I'm saying? I'm not saying she was ugly, but I'm just saying that she's not as attractive as the chick that I was trying to talk to earlier part of the night. You know what I'm saying? You know? I'm walking out. She looked at me. I looked back at her. I'm like, fuck. You know what I mean? And she was like, she hit me with the, I've been looking at you all night, but I saw that you was trying to talk to the other girl. So, I mean, what you want to do? I'm like, listen, what you want to do? I said, look, what you want to do? And then, you know, it happens. So sometimes, so then that's the chick. Right, so that's the chick that end up like, you know, listen, okay. Like they stragglers. They just stragglers, man. Like you just stragglers. Like you hit them up, like you know, they're not ugly. They just not as attractive as the chick that you was trying to get earlier part of the night. They was convenient. You know what I'm saying? They was like, come on over. You know, you get there for whatever reason. She already had like sandwiches in the microwave and shit. I don't know what the fuck that was about. You know what I'm saying? Shit like that.
She was hungry when she got home.
Yeah, like, I don't know, but she had sandwiches. And they were, she was like, because you know how you come in and you be like, you want anything to drink? Right? I was like, oh, you know, I have a bottle of water. She was like, well, I got some Kool-Aid. I got some iced tea and I got some lemonade. I was like, oh, shit, for real, you do? And then she was like, oh, there's some sandwiches in the microwave. Sandwiches. What kind of sandwiches do you have already pre-made in the microwave for me? You know what I'm saying? Like, did you know? Did you get a vision? How did you know I was coming over to eat these sandwiches? You know what I'm saying? And then she said, well, if you don't want those, if you don't want the sandwiches, you know, I can just cook you whatever you like. I said, whatever I like. She's like, yeah, what do you want to eat? I'm like, I'm going to start with these sandwiches as an appetizer. Let me go ahead and get these sandwiches. What else you got? You know what I'm saying? The next thing you know, she in there. She made some pancakes. She made some bacon. She made some eggs. She made some grits. She made some biscuits and some cinnamon buns. I'm just telling you what she did for me. I'm just telling you. You know what I mean? I'm just trying to tell you what she did. I mean, that was my experience. She was just a straggler, though. So those you don't really take out in the daytime. Nighttime. Night fighter. You know what I'm saying? At nighttime. You know what I'm saying? And then the thing about it is, you know, a couple of nights of that shit, you know, they will approach you on some, I know you're never going to take me out anywhere. You know, I know. And I'm like, well, you know, listen. I'm glad you know. I'm glad. You know. So everyone knows what's going on.
What?
But, That's happened. Like, listen, we're not going to go nowhere. Like, let's not think that shit. We're not going to go anywhere. No, we're not going to do that.
So
no,
this
no.
will be the episode Brian gets all the judgy eyes.
I'm going to get all the judgy eyes. Listen, I mean, but this.
My experience was this. My club experience was a little bit different. I went in psychological warfare. I go in the club, be a group of females around. I find the hurtest chick in that group. I'm like, excuse me, ladies. You want to dance? And they're like, he taking Denise over this shit? Ugly as fuck. So me and Denise over there dancing, having a good time. They looking at her like, what's up with
him? He must be a nice guy. He must be nice.
And because I was nice, I was more attractive to them because I was dancing with their ugly ass friend. Now they really in my face now, and I ain't had to do shit. I just danced with ugly motherfuckers.
That's happened. I mean, that's the thing. That's a thing. That's your. But like, seriously though, like, so what I'm saying, face. Those are stragglers. You know what I'm saying? So. Yeah, so, I mean, that's just what happened. All I'm saying is, I say all that to say this. The same way women know when they want to give it up to a man. Sometimes, men, we know when we want to make sure we want to give it to you too. So what I'm saying is, when we all are adults in this situation, why do we always end up acting like we don't know what the fuck it is? Why do we act like we don't know that we're attracted to this person? Because I'm not saying just because you're attracted to somebody that you got to fuck them. No one is saying that. But you goddamn got an inkling that you might. You know what I'm saying? So when that said man starts rubbing on your pussy, don't act like, oh my goodness, what are you doing? Why are you doing that? And why are you touching me there? Like, the fuck? You know why I'm touching you there, because there's something inside your pants that I want to get to right now. That's all I'm saying. Amazon package, dick delivered. Bam.
But okay. First, you got to remember, you got to dig in your ear first.
You got to dig in your ear. Did you do that to me?
No way.
It's like,
Yeah, I mean, you know, but that's what happens, though. But that's what it is, though. Like, I mean, you know, like, I think things are just a little different from men to women. You know what I'm saying? It's like, you know, when you go out, like, that's the reason. That's the main reason.
The other thing is, though, women, though, we never want to feel like we're easy, right? So I think some of that is just us trying to...
Who gives a fuck? Who cares?
Play hard to get, yeah.
Why? Hard to get for what?
Because we don't ever want to come across like this is just easy pussy, right? We never want, even though we might want to fuck you as bad, if not more, than you want to fuck, we never want to come across as like this is just easy pussy. Like, you know, we always, I think, you know, we were kind of also raised, right? You're raised from the time you're young that, like, you shouldn't just be passing out the pussy. Like, you got to make these niggas work for the pussy. You shouldn't, you know what I mean? So...
Work for the
pussy. But maybe she went to the club with the same mission that you went to the club with. She already had the sandwiches in the microwave.
I mean, maybe she did. I mean, because I think she knew that she
said, we want you to work for it. We at least want to feel like you put in a little work for it.
Why?
Because we've been taught our whole lives that
What does that extra work do? What does it really gain? What? I held out for some dick that you knew you wanted anyway? I don't understand. Like, what? You're going to get a trophy?
Because we don't want to give y'all the wrong idea, because we want to make ourselves feel like, you know, we upheld our worth and we made you understand our worth and that you can't just, you know. And then, because here's the other thing, let's just be honest. Does the thought not cross your mind if she let you have a pussy that quick, that fast, that easy? That she lets every nigga have the pussy that quick, that fast, that easy? Or you never
think? Here's the thing. It doesn't, for me, let me explain something to you. Ready? You ready for this one? I don't give a fuck about what you did before with somebody motherfucking else at that moment. What I'm worried about is what the fuck is you doing with me? And then it's like, again, it's about what happens after that, right? So after that, like, that's the key to it all. Like, what happens after that? Right now, after talking to her, you might find out, like, yeah, nigga, I get his pussy to every nigga. Then that might be the chick that you might not want to fuck with. They don't. But at that moment in that time, it's like, okay, I'm not worried about them niggas, right? Who gives a fuck?
That's hard, because that's definitely how women think, right? I for some reason always had a nigga volunteering to eat my pussy, right? Always had a nigga volunteering to eat my pussy. And they would even say things like, I don't even want to fuck you, I just want to eat your pussy. Say things like, oh, you just look like your pussy tastes good, right? And so the first thing that comes to my mind is, this nigga must do this with every woman. He must eat everybody pussy, right? So I guess we assume that men think the way we think. Whenever a man does something for you and he does it quickly, the first thought is, he must do this for every bitch.
Listen, all I'm saying is to you is this. We're grown. Just take responsibility for the shit that you do. I'm okay with it. I'm fine with it. That's just me. I'm okay with that. You know, I'll have mine now.
If she gave you the pussy that quick, she would do it for every nigga?
Yeah.
See?
I'll have mine now, thank you. I don't need to work for it, you know. I don't need to do all that. That's just, you know, give it to me.
I'm okay working for it, but it's when you make me work extra for it, I'm like, come on now. That's when I'm like, now what the fuck are we doing?
You mentioned like what, like you know what it is.
I get that.
You done already told me you thought I was sexy. You already told me that, huh? You already told me I was sexy.
So
you already I'm sexy.
I wonder how you were in bed. That's letting me know you thought about us fucking. So all the extra shit, it, to me, is like this. I go to work to do a job to get paid, right?
Huh?
I don't get paid for extra work I do unless it's overtime. So to me,
right.
So you know you try to fuck. I put in some work. Everybody wins. This extra work, like you said, what's coming with the extra work? What the hell do I get?
I'm just trying to understand the extra work. That's all I want to know. Like, what, like, work for what? You want to make sure that he don't do it with everybody else and all that and all. I mean, fuck, I don't get it. Because my thing is, if you thought I did it with everybody else, you think I do it with everybody else, then just be like, okay, nah, I think you do it with everybody else, and just leave me alone. But if you think that, but you keep talking to me any fucking way.
Because we want you to prove to us that we're special and different.
Listen, I'll prove to you that you're special later. Okay, later.
No, because really, most women think the only real leverage I have over this nigga is this pussy, right? And we know that the quicker we give you the pussy, the easier and the quicker it is for you to disappear, right? But if you're still working and trying to get the pussy, we can drag that out a little longer to get what we need and want from y'all, or what we think we need and want from you, before we go ahead. Because once we give you the pussy, it's over, right? You done got the prize. You got what you wanted. And
you got what you wanted. Everybody wins.
Now that you done got what you wanted, it's really a luck of the draw whether I'm ever here from this nigga again. Or whether he gonna ever act right again, or whether he gonna ever take me out again. Yes. Once y'all get
no,
the pussy,
but it's not. But no,
it's
but
really
it's not
Russian roulette. No, it's Russian roulette.
It's not. No. Listen. Whether you end up around the next day, the day after that, or the day after that, trust and believe. It's not because you gave me the pussy the first day I met you. It's not because you gave me the pussy 2 days. It's not because you gave me the pussy 6 months motherfucking later. Okay. It's all on how you act after that and what we do after that. If we start to have a connection, we talk, we bond, we hang, we do, that's the shit. But if your energy fucking changes after we fuck, then my energy's probably going to motherfucking change.
Yeah, because you know why? Because before you got the pussy, nigga, you was calling every day. You was trying to take me out. You was trying to spend some time with me. But sometimes y'all's energy changes after you get the pussy. Now
right, so now
the pussy.
How about this though? How about this? Now that you gave me the pussy, now all of a sudden, you gonna stop call? What? You not gonna call me now? Or you not gonna this? Then you start this whole nagging shit because you gave me the pussy. Wait a minute, hold on, wait.
No, we start.
I'm still calling.
Nagging shit because like
hold
I said,
on, I'm wait. I'm
day.
Still calling. I'm still
no,
calling.
You was calling
what
every
the fuck?
Day,
like shit.
Three times a day. Till I gave you
now
you went three days to call me.
You missed one phone call. Oh, you was just trying to fuck me and that's it? No, nigga, no. Fuck. Calm down. Listen, it's just noon. God damn it. Fuck. You know what I'm saying?
One more comment so I get some more judgy eyes. Let's just get out today.
Out.
If I met you, we was out somewhere and I met you and I wasn't really feeling you or you were coming across too goofy or stupid or whatever you was doing that I didn't like, the phone number I gave you, said, what's your phone number? I would either tell it to you quick so you wouldn't catch on or I'd write it down and slip it to you so you wouldn't look at it. Phone number was always 240-765-4321.
That's you gave a fake number?
This is 1-7 backwards. If you say it fast, they don't catch on. But if they get it, they read it, they'll be like, 765. This one gave me a fake number. That's why I do it quick. Or I slide it to you and roll out. wasn't shit.
The people just keep saying, wow.
But that's, all I'm saying is, I'm just saying, it really doesn't matter the amount of time or how fast you give it to me. If I like you, I like you. If I don't, I don't. If you end up doing, so, like, for instance, you can make me wait 6 fucking months to get this fucking pussy. 6 months. And if you still do some crazy shit after that, oh, well. I'm still not going to fucking talk to you. You know what I'm saying? That's all I'm saying. It is not about, for me, it's not about that.
Okay,
it's not about how
you get but there. I'm just giving you the insight into the woman's thought process and the woman's mind. It's like, basically, this pussy is the only real leverage, the only thing I have to negotiate with, right? And very often, whether you are the one who does it or not, there are a lot of men who very often, really? Well, yes, very often, once they get the pussy, they don't even act like the same nigga.
Really? Are you kidding me? I'm gonna do some research on that one.
So here's the thing. Like Ryan just said, I don't mind putting in the work. Guess what? Once you get the pussy, most men think, my work here is done, right? So whatever work they thought they was putting in to get to the pussy, once they get the pussy, my work here is done. So now they think that they're just supposed to get the pussy since I got it once. I mean, once we already had that first time, like, nigga, I'm supposed to get this pussy every time I want it. And I no longer have to do any work because I did that already. Like, the work that they put in lasts forever.
That's
nice. A lot of men are that way.
Well, I'm gonna go talk to some more men.
You were the dude that was calling me every day, sending me that good morning, gorgeous every morning, you know, asking me how my day was, and, you know, you bringing me lunch and shit like that. And then the minute that I give you the pussy, I don't hear from you for 3 straight days.
But you
3 days?
So that's my thing.
Yeah, 3 days. Now, every day before that, you just like me so much, or this vibe, this connection, this, that. Hey, I was just dropping off lunch.
Hold on.
Oh, I just want to come through and just see you and say hi.
Hold on.
Doing all of that shit, but the minute you get the pussy, 3 days later, I ain't heard from you. Hold then on. You call me out the blue the third, fourth day. Hey, what's up with you? Nigga.
Listen, you keep saying it's 3 days. Jesus went back for 3 days and came back.
You see, Mitra says... Mitra says exactly Ebony. So y'all think, like, we're not making this shit up. Like, you know what I mean? We didn't become this way because of us. Like, y'all put us in this place where, like, now we're like, okay, let me reevaluate how I'm doing this shit. Because once this nigga gets the pussy, it literally is like Russian roulette. Even if we made you wait 6 months. I'm not talking about, like, how long they wait to fuck you. I'm simply saying that at whatever point they give you pussy, whether it was the first night, the 100th night, at whatever point we give you pussy, we know in our minds that now it is a Russian roulette as to whether you will continue to stay around or you will continue to work at this relationship or you will want anything more. It's Russian roulette. We're just spinning the wheel and seeing where it lands.
All I'm saying is it's not because you're giving the pussy. It's because of what you do after you give me the pussy or how your attitude is. Period. That's all I'm fucking saying.
And what,
like,
I'm
after
saying
you give it
is,
to me,
that's an unfair
you
assessment.
Start tripping.
No, what I'm saying is that's an unfair assessment because, like I said, if you was calling me every day and doing whatever you was doing, then I'd give you the pussy, then you disappear for 3 days, then you call me on the 4th day, and then I'm saying to you, why I haven't heard from you in the last 3 days? Now, you're going to say, you want to tell your boys, yo, this bitch went off on me because I ain't calling for 3 days. It's her fault. After she gave you the pussy, why you stop fucking with her? But if you really look back on it, it's you, nigga, who stopped doing the shit you was doing
that made her have to ask
these questions and go this place with you.
Hold on, not always, because some women, not all, I'm saying some, who after they give you the pussy, they go like, so you gonna call me tomorrow? So you gonna call me tomorrow? This goes back to you not having no fucking cop. Shut the fuck up. I'm gonna call you. If I don't, life ain't gonna end. But don't sit up here and just be like, so you're going to call me tomorrow? So you're going to call me? You sure you're going to call me? I want you to call me. Make sure you call me. That shit will be like, nah, nigga. Look, you acted too clingy now.
Again, because we know that now that you have gotten the prize, it is Russian roulette. So now she wants some reassurance that, okay, now that I finally gave you the pussy, I just want some reassurance. Am I going to still hear from you tomorrow, nigga? Like, because that's how it feels for us. It's always like,
you're going to hear from me. Just don't start tripping. Like, you're going to hear from me. I'm going to call you. You know what I'm saying? I mean, the fuck? I'm gonna call.
So you
know what I'm saying? Even a chick that made me sandwiches. I called her. Yes, I called her. She listened. She made me sandwiches and pancakes and Cinnabon. I called her. You know what I'm saying? Shit, yes.
You see? I called her too. And that's why
you know what I'm saying?
Because she knew she was a night fighter. She had
sandwiches in the fucking microwave. I will never forget that. She said, "Do you want something to drink?" I was like, "Yeah." She's like, "I got this, I got that, and I got sandwiches in the microwave." I said, "Fucking sandwiches in the microwave? You're fucking kidding me!" I opened the microwave. To my surprise, there were fucking sandwiches in the fucking microwave.
What kind of sandwiches were they, Paul?
Listen, there was ham and cheese sandwiches. Ham and cheese.
The ones you made yourself.
Ham and cheese fucking sandwiches. Do you understand what the fuck I'm saying? Okay? And then she gave me options. She said, "Do you want mayonnaise or do you want Miracle Whip? Which one do you want?" I said, "I'll take the mayonnaise. I don't fuck with Miracle Whip." You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? And yeah, I don't do Miracle Whip. I like mayonnaise. And she put the mayonnaise, gave me the sandwiches. Like, if you don't want that, I can cook you some. I said, "What you gonna cook?" She cooked me pancakes, eggs, sausage, fucking, I'm trying to tell you, I was like, oh shit, this is fantastic. I'm trying to tell you, it was great. Yeah, it was. I'm just telling you what she did. She had sandwiches.
You also said you never take her out.
No.
Everything is in the house.
One Scorpio says, in the microwave, how long were they? Had they been in there? They were still
soft. Listen, I didn't ask.
She made them before she left, so they were soft in the microwave because she knew her ass was going to be hungry when she got home.
Yeah, exactly.
Listen, I didn't ask. I didn't ask how long they was in the microwave. I was just tripping off the fact that the motherfucker had fucking pre-ready-made sandwiches except for the mayonnaise in the microwave. And I was like, wow, this is fucking...
Because everybody's hungry when they leave the club.
Yeah, I know, nigga. That's why we used to go to the Waffle House back in the Waffle House.
Waffle House and IHOP.
Or Denny's. I don't like Denny's, though.
We've had this conversation. The eggs over Miami are very good.
Fuck that nasty shit. Just because you give it a fancy name, that doesn't make your food delicious.
The eggs over Miami are really good.
Fuck eggs over Miami, because the shit is nasty. They just try to give all their little fucking food fucking fancy name, fresh and fruity, rooty, tooty, batooty, all that shit is nasty.
I haven't had it in a long time because the last time I had eggs over Miami, I got in trouble. So I'm gonna tell y'all this quick story and then we getting off because it's 10:09.
Yeah.
11:09 for y'all.
Yeah, so, right.
I was at an LS party. I was playing bartender, right? Because y'all know I'm a jack of all trades, right? So I'm back behind the bar, right? You know what I mean? I'm passing out water, drinks, whatever, whatever. And the dude comes. I thought the dude was attractive or whatever, but my one of my friends had introduced him as her dude or whatever. You know what I mean? She's like, "This is my dude" or whatever. So I'm like, okay, cool. So all I remember is that at some point, he had me behind the bar across a bar stool eating my pussy, right?
What? Hold on. What? Eating your pussy? What? Excuse me?
Yeah, right. So he had me behind the bar stool, behind the bar across. My back hurt like shit because, you know what I mean? But I was in this bar stool, however I had situationed myself, and he was eating my pussy. And I remember that she came over to him, and this went on for a good while, right? And she came over to him and was like, "All right, Luther, it's time for you to jump up out the pussy."
Luther?
Why are we throwing names out?
No, his name wasn't Luther. That's from a movie. What movie was that? Some movie. And I didn't know that at the time, right? I was like, wait, what? I thought his name was...
Oh, that's from Set It Off. That's from Set It Off.
Yeah.
That's from Set It Off. Set It Off.
So she told him it was time for him to jump about the pussy. So he gets up or whatever. By this time, the lights is on. The party's closing down or whatever. And, you know, I'm making plans to go home because as far as I was concerned, we did what we did at the party. It was what it was. But he wanted me to come back to the hotel room with the two of them. So I kept saying, "I'm real hungry. I can't do that right now because I'm really hungry." He was like, "Well, what do you want to eat?" And he was like, "The only thing that's, you know, open and nearby is Denny's or whatever." He's like, "What do you want to eat?" I was like, "Oh, I like the eggs over my hammy," right? And so the girl was like, "I don't want Denny's." And he turned around to her and was like, she want Denny's, right? So now I'm looking like, what's happening? I'm not, I always say I'm never here to break up anybody's happy home. I just visit, right? So I'm like, what? Well, if she doesn't, like, I can just go to Denny's. Like, y'all can do y'all thing. And he's like, no. I really want you to come back to the room with us. So if you want Denny's, I'm getting Denny's. So now I'm over here having a conversation with her, like, listen, I'm not real clear what's going on. She was like, you know what? It doesn't even matter. He wants you to come back or whatever. We'll get Denny's. He went to Denny's. He got my food. He brought it back and laid out everything all nicely. Do you need this? Do you need that? Are you good? Are you good? Whatever. And so, yeah. So it just got me. Well, it didn't really get, kind of got me in trouble. But so I just haven't had Denny's ever since then, because to me now it has like a little mar, a little scar on it now, because I wasn't trying to create no issues for the two of them. You know what I mean?
Damn, moon over my hammies. Fuck that sandwich.
My hammy.
Fuck that sandwich. That shit was, it was nasty. It's a nasty ass sandwich.
It was really, I love the moon over my hammy. It's so good to me. I love ham.
Fuck that. Anyway, listen.
But I didn't get the moon over Miami,
dude. So nasty. Anyway, well, we're going to go ahead and sign off now. I'm not playing no closeout music because I can't even fucking find this shit right now anyway. So we just going to say thank y'all for tuning in. And just know that every show is probably going to end up about sex, because that's what we do. And what's wrong?
Nothing.
You're just now looking at my message, aren't you?
No.
Oh. Anyway. Why your face look like that all of a sudden? Do we need to stay on for 15 more minutes to find out why your face look like that?
No.
That means yes. That means you guys are gonna call me after the show, doesn't it? That's what it means. No, they're gonna call me. Nope. No. Okay, well, thank you guys for tuning in to Steel Radio. I'm your man, Steel. That is Ebony, a.k.a. Miss Hot Topic, who always brings the dirt. And my man, Brian B. Rabbit, a.k.a. the Green Eye Genie. Sorry that we didn't play no closeout music, but
yeah. Don't nobody care about that music but you. Just saying.
Really?
Really?
You don't care about the music?
I want something else.
Anyway, we're gonna sign off now. We'll see y'all Tuesday at 8:30. We'll talk about something. You guys send in some topics to Ebony and tell us what y'all want to talk about, so we don't have to feel like we talk about the same shit or shit all the time. You guys can get some topics too. Shit. All right.
All right. Did we say